Live from Mixed Vibes Radio, this is the Mike and Sean Show. We know more than you, but even if we don't,
we're gonna say that we do.
Happy, happy Thursday, baby.
Happy Thursday, everybody. It is February 11th, Thursday, 7 p.m. We're running just about 3 minutes late, but it's good because the build's the build up a little bit more than what we were anticipating. So thank you very much for being here with us tonight. And we want to welcome all our viewers, listeners, whether you're in the car, at home, wherever you are. How you been, Mikey boy?
Fantastic, man. Looking forward to this. Gets a little nervous and was like, let me have a drink or two. Then I had three and I was like, all right, I got this. I think
three was a trick.
I think three was it. That's
we,
it for
we
now
got,
on.
We got four, five, six, and seven just in case.
I'm here, there, all over the spot.
Which is, it's a crutch.
It's a crutch. I need to lean on something. I'll
no offense to handicap people. Sorry.
Wasn't even going there, but thank you for jumping in that one.
Just,
I appreciate
I'm
that.
I'm keeping it politically correct. But I mean, I'm going
to
try.
No offense to cripple people. Politically correct.
Yeah, that's no offense. Politically correct.
Yeah.
Thank you, everybody, again, for tuning in. This is our first internet radio podcast.
Episode one, legit.
And we're super, super duper excited about it. I don't think I've ever said super duper in my life, but I'm very excited. You can tell because I'm saying stuff that I would never normally say.
Right. The nerves are kicking in. You're like, oh.
It is. I've done this for a while in the entertainment field. I've been in studio, QC equipment, testing stuff. And you never really get.
Until you're doing it.
I had butterflies all day today. I'm not going to lie to you. All day today.
I wasn't thinking about it much. And then you asked me if I was nervous. And then I was like, well. Now I'm nervous.
I think, once you address the issue, then
you are deep down inside. 100%. Well, I mean, look, hey, Valentine's Day is right here. And
is that how we're opening the show?
That's what we're opening with Valentine's Day.
We're not going to open with Valentine's Day, are we?
We're going to open with Valentine's Day. I think it's
everybody. Right.
We're leading into it. The weekend's finally here. Look, before we could open up these bars and restaurants so that people can go in, even a small amount, we didn't have anything. We didn't have a weekend. We didn't have a day. Every day was day one, day two, day three.
That's a fair point.
It wasn't a real weekend. We didn't have anything. What were you looking forward to?
I mean...
Right. But even though there's something open, now you, even if you don't go, at least you have that option. Before, it was just a day.
Right.
Day one.
No, I understand that point completely. I think that the fact that it fell on Valentine's Day is a little annoying because it's just a superficial, made-up, douchey holiday.
Douchey.
It really is. I mean,
as an adult,
love your partner every day. Not just, and right. I get that they're honoring love that day. Blah blah blah. Right. But it's really all about commercialism.
Yes.
And but, you know what? In some sense, capitalism, because right now small businesses can use it.
Okay,
so I guess I'm wrong.
If they lead into it.
I stand
it.
Corrected.
Okay.
Because small businesses are definitely going to benefit.
Right. So it's the boost now. Right.
And they're small businesses will be open. Small businesses like Rebar by the Bridge, 150th.
Rebar by the Bridge.
Yeah. 1540, 150th, though. Whitestone, Queens.
Whitestone.
But yeah, if these small businesses can all make a little bit from us being open and from us being, kind of back to normal with a 25% capacity, which it sucks, but it helps.
Right, it's a little something. It starts
is.
That
so
way.
So I'm happy about that. So
But they're reaching out with that little something on a stick, saying, "Here, come take it."
Right,
be like, "Oh my god,
dangling
I
the
thank
carrot."
Them. Oh my god, they're so
but,
great for opening
this
up.
Yeah, it's listen. We will never ever get into religion and politics on a show. You guys have our word with that.
Mm.
You will never ever do that. But I will tell you this: if I'm pissed about something, I'm going to say something, regardless of what line it falls on. And the whole shutdown thing is something that we're passionately about annoyed about, because there are definitely people being hurt because of this. And that's something that we all need to like stick together, shop small business, spend some money locally, stop with the Amazon, stop with the online shopping.
That's the hard part. Is
unless they're small business, because everything is pretty much online shopping.
Amazon
now
has taken over. You know, do you remember watching, like say, RoboCop?
Yep.
And there was a company that owned everything. I forgot the name of it, but it owned everything.
Right.
It was on everything, everything you bought, the cops, everything, the police station. That's what Amazon is. Amazon has decided to infiltrate the small, like, listen, I'll help you out. I'll buy your inventory and I'll pay you a little something, you know, and they go off and they took everything. And that's what it is. That's RoboCop, futuristic, horrible 80s movie. Amazon taking over.
Right.
Amazon's the logo that takes over.
It's like the show Mr. Robot, Evil Corp.
Yeah.
We will take your soul and your money at the same time. Yeah. And actually bring, you know what? I could tell you one thing. In regards to Amazon,
yeah,
to me the coolest, most important person, one of, I shouldn't say the most, but the coolest, one of the most important people on the planet, Elon Musk, has recently passed one of the biggest douches on the planet, and that's the owner of Amazon.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm actually really happy about that. Congratulations to Elon Musk. He made a lot of people that we know some money. And I'll tell you one thing. Whether or not you understand what the whole idea with Tesla is going on, there's enough research, and I've done enough myself, to know that this guy cares about the planet. He cares about people. The guy just happens to be a billionaire because he's brilliant, and he made shit that was easy for normal people to use.
Right.
And not only just that, but in a sense of making life easier moving forward. You know, we're a progressive race of people. And you know,
if
we're going to be stuck in the mud on certain bullshit issues like, you know, fossil fuels and stuff. And that's, again, no politics.
That's
we're not getting into it.
Right,
but my point is important people need to be shouted out. And to me, Elon Musk is a really super important guy. The guy, and he passed, again, a big scumbag.
Right. But
a guy who is bleeding the planet dry.
Right. And you take a guy, Elon Musk, who to risk
his,
a
his
lot.
His girlfriend's a mess, though. Have you seen her?
Yes.
Oh, my.
But what's her name again?
I don't know, but she's weird looking. And I'm not a judgy guy.
But, listen,
but yo, we're going to keep shit real on the show.
I'm not going to judge, she's a mess.
She looks like somebody you'd hire for a bachelor party.
Right.
You know, for like to hang
the
from.
The last
like,
one. She's the last
hang,
one to
show hang from
up.
Like a bungee cord with like piercings everywhere.
Hey, could you jump off that chair through that
yo,
glass
to each
table?
His own, though. Rock out. You know what I'm saying?
Well, he goes on the Joe Rogan show, right?
Yeah.
And he gets high as a kite.
Smoke
and if
joint,
you listen to him with his philosophy, what happens after that? His investors were like, I want to take my money out of this company. How dare you do that? But then there was some, you know, the regular guy who was like, I love him because he got high.
Some people went after him, though. Some people attacked him for actually smoking
weed.
Well,
because you get,
they're like, I can't believe Elon Musk. He's so smart. How is he smoking the weed that makes people
how
stupid?
How dare you? It's the gateway. It's the gateway.
It's the gateway. I can't believe he's not doing heroin already. And that was 3 weeks ago.
Well, yeah, like, well, good thing that Joe Rogan doesn't do heroin. Otherwise, he probably would have been like.
Stupid people will be called out on the show. I don't know if you paid attention, or I'm sorry, I shouldn't say pay attention. If you watched our preview show, there were certain things that I basically said, we're not going to have rules, but we're going to have some kind of guidelines.
Right.
And
you broke them.
Right. Well, no, I didn't break them.
You broke that. Well, we had the one about the cursing, right?
Right. Well, no, we said we're going to keep cursing to a minimum because it's unnecessary unless it's descriptive.
Right.
Unless it's under, like utterly necessary.
When it has a meaning.
Not offensive in any sense of the word.
Not offensive.
But we probably will say things at times that might offend people.
Yeah,
and the only 100%. Reason is because my idea of offensive might be different from somebody else's. And that is part of a great part of being American.
Yeah.
Everybody has their own choices, their own ideas.
Well, that's.
So I'm sorry. And if it makes somebody who's a worthy listener tune out, then I apologize to you in advance. But I'm not going to not be me for the sake of, you know, keeping listeners.
If you apologize to say, like, listen, I'm sorry I said this word. And
Mike, anybody that knows us knows that we're not offensive guys.
Nah.
That's all there is to it.
Nah.
So if you listen to us with an open mind, if you listen to us with any kind of, like, again.
If you have predetermined restrictions, this is not for you.
Right. If you feel like.
Stop now, because the disclaimer is, you're going to hear the word fuck a lot. a lot. It's a verb. It's descriptive.
Mike loves that word.
I love it. I love it so much. I got a ring with the word on it.
Yes.
To describe, and just in case I don't feel like saying it, so I can
show
it.
He could just show it to people.
I could just show it to people.
And you know what? And honestly, I swear to you, just because of the way of the world and the way things are today, nowadays, with social media.
Yeah.
And, you know, like I said, the masses of dumbasses have absolutely, like, taken over social media. So a lot of dumb shit is actually accepted as real truth these days. A lot of stuff. And in every sense. And you know what it really started with me? And I'll be honest with you. And this is like going to be a natural segue for us because we are definitely a sports-related kind of show.
Okay.
But, excuse me, guys, I'm a little raspy today because I'm a little nervous. But so I used to take the 7 train or the railroad, depending on how much money I had for the month back in the day when I lived in Flushing. Right. Or when I lived in Whitestone, and I would drive to the Long Island Railroad. So part of my every single day routine was reading a newspaper. You know what I'm saying? And back in the day, and I know you can relate to this because you don't drive. So everywhere you went, you probably read a newspaper, right? I would imagine.
Well, only when I get wherever I get where and when I was going to work, I'd read it at work.
Right. So essentially, you understand what I'm talking about in a sense of reading a newspaper,
yeah,
like, so like religion.
My community, yes, yeah, yeah. So
right.
I
could remember articles from specific writers.
Books,
and
I also read books on that. And
so, you know, so leads me to my, education. You know, point. Fake news,
fake
which
news.
Is like a big thing nowadays, like every, you know, and again, it's real because these news.
It comes from somewhere. A little bit of that piece.
The media,
little
is essentially a bunch of savages. And all that's just what it is.
There's no side that's more true than the other
right.
one.
I feel we're blessed that we can have a mic in front of us in this era,
right.
in these days, and be on social media and have people listening and watching and doing all this shit and making our point, because back then you couldn't do that. But
right.
but now the accountability level is higher, and it's like the threshold fell. Because back then, everybody had honor. Like these honor, you know, like Mushnick and these guys back in the 80s and 90s, you know, Lupica when he wrote for the news. And
yep.
all of these guys had, I shouldn't say morals, that's not the right word, but they had pride in their work.
Right, but yes, so now what they do, like it's the Times, and so it's write your article. It doesn't matter if you have all the facts, right? You don't have
just
to
start
be
a story.
Just
sell
start
papers.
The story and we'll see what happens.
Well, but my point is, this is my point. That I believe the fake news trend started with New York sports media in the late 90s and early 2000s. And you know what a perfect example is? One of our freaking biggest heroes as Met fans would be Michael Aloysius James Piazza.
Piazza.
Do you remember the rumor about Mike Piazza?
The fact that yes, I do, and you know what?
Do you remember that rule?
Yeah.
I mean that rumor?
The rumor.
The rumor?
Sam Champion. Well,
Sam Champion.
Sam Champion.
That Mike Piazza was putting Sam Champion's penis in his mouth.
Oh, no, no, no,
this
no,
was
no.
the rumor.
I know, but it was, they moved in together.
They lived
That's
together.
How they
had a secret life
right.
together.
And
they actually snuck away for a gay wedding, which I heard, I read in one of the not so mainstream papers. But anyway,
right.
this
they
story,
had to push that
this
agenda.
Story actually had legs in New
right,
York.
Right, it did.
It
because
had legs.
People were like, well, it has to be. It has to be true.
It's amazing.
If they're writing in the news, it has to be true,
dude,
right?
Dude, it's crazy. And I think that I feel like I noticed it then because I'm like, this is ridiculous, you
yes.
know? And then like a year later, he married Miss Universe, had 5 kids, made the perfect
but
life.
The fact, wait, but even better, he had to come out with a press conference.
He had
to say,
deny that
deny
he was, that he was having
sex
with a local weatherman.
Weatherman.
Which, I mean, this is New York, bro. Right. And people wonder why athletes don't want to play here.
Right.
Like, are you kidding me?
Well, I had
And listen, Sam Chambers is a good-looking dude. So if you ever accuse me of being gay,
it might be with
I'm
Sam
down.
Champion, yeah.
I'm cool with
but
that.
But even Mike Piazza, it's like $125 million. Like,
you listen,
gay for
you
that.
Know what?
You'd
honestly, personally, I know that Piazza is a little bit of a douche when it comes to the fans, or he was as a person, kind of like Jeter. They were shut down. They didn't like interacting with people. But that being said, what's right is right, and bullshit is bullshit.
Yeah.
And that's the media, I feel, that because all you got to do is say, yes, we have credible sources that just said that Mike
sources?
Piazza was at dinner. Oh, my sources? I'm sorry. I can't give you my sources.
Well, can you give us another story
no,
on
because
it?
It's, you know, anonymity is a big part of how we work. So we have to protect our sources because it's illegal for us to give up the people who give us our information
yeah.
that may or may not be bullshit.
Okay, so I'm going to believe that. I'm going to go with what you said because you don't want to give up. Okay, I believe it.
But by the way,
yes?
Mike Piazza and Sam Champion are gay lovers. I just want you to know that.
I believe it.
Okay,
I don't
so
need
you know,
facts. I don't even need them to be married.
I don't need a fact either. I'm just all I need is my voice
all
and a microphone.
And a finger to point in the air.
And a rumor and a finger.
And a rumor.
And a finger to stick in his boop boop. Anyway,
there it goes.
So listen,
right
now that we're now that
right out the window,
it's gone.
Perfect. Didn't take long.
Trash. Sorry, Aunt Pat. I love you.
Sorry, Aunt Pat. Trash.
Shout out to Joe Lanzillo driving to an appointment. One of my real estate team members, okay. A-Team Real Estate. If you are buying or selling or anything in regards to real estate, you have any questions, call me, Sean Lynch, A-Team Real Estate, 516-399-7333. That's one of my first plugs that we're going to do today. It's a personal thing. And yeah, we're paying for all of this, so we get to do whatever we want.
Get your business out there, yeah.
We have no sponsors, no marketing, nothing on the show. This is
not
all
yet.
Me and Michael.
Soon.
Whatever. Well, listen, we're going to play it by ear. I like the freedom of saying whatever the hell I want anyway. And we will also be showing lots of love to our fellow small business owners and small businesses locally. So if you guys have any, if you're interested at all in having us mention your stuff on our podcast, contact myself or Michael, let us know anytime you want. We'll definitely add it to our lineup of small businesses that we're going to promote. So
now we go to the most important,
pay it forward.
The most important conversation, the immediate conversation, is the Super Bowl.
Oh my
God.
We
just went through another Super Bowl.
Yes. And I was 100% wrong.
And in that Super Bowl, I didn't pick a side.
I did. Oh, I picked my numbers, but
prior to that,
I thought Mahomes would win.
As a Jets fan, I don't want to see Brady succeed.
Right.
Because when he did succeed, it was at my cost, my team's cost.
Right.
But this conversation of the GOAT, this is the whole point.
Yes. Which is a term, we're going to get to this later, but this is a term that's used way too often.
So prior to this and all these rumored scandals, again, the rumors of the Deflategate and
Spygate.
Douchegate.
He's married to Giselle Gate. Actually, you know
married
what?
Married to Giselle Gate.
I got a great, remind me, I don't want to cut you off, but remind me, I got a great Giselle story when I worked in Life and Style.
Okay, so.
But I did, I cut him off.
Yeah, you did.
People told me that I stepped on your
throat. That's all right.
On a preview word.
You mean right,
so
like right now?
I'm going to stop that. I'm going to stop that from now on, okay?
You mean right now?
Go ahead, Mike, I'm sorry.
Anyway, so we got.
But
we
anyway,
have,
so I want.
We have the Super Bowl, right?
And then
we sit there, and there are people that were like that wanted Tom Brady to lose last year, but wanted him to win this year.
Right.
Because I think the thing is about proving yourself on another team in a whole new system and all new players
right.
shows how good you are. Prior to this, I would say
I agree 100%. Even though their weapons were just, I mean, Tampa
amazing. Had. But Joe Montana, right? Joe Montana gets kicked out of San Francisco. He goes to Kansas City. He takes him to the conference championship with a Marcus Allen. And an amazing defense.
Old Marcus Allen.
A couple of good receivers, a great defense. They just miss it, right? So the debate was always, not always, but the debate has become Brady, Montana, and people like, oh my God, you know, Tom Brady is the best. So you look at what he has all these weapons, but he convinced Gronkowski to come out of retirement. The Gronk came out of retirement.
Which I think that's what I was wrong about most because I didn't think Gronk had anything left. Considering with some of the interviews he had done
earlier.
Was
beat up
because he was promoting THC, his body was broken down, and he, you know, that was probably just marketing to sell more
right.
pills, you know. But he was like talking about on every interview he was saying, he's like, I'm done, I can't do this no more, the NFL, it's too demanding on your body for me to take a year off and, you know, just
right.
take an off season off and just expect to be able to play, and he did.
And then he convinced Fournette was Antonio Brown, like these little pieces of people that through the year, and you know, that defense is really, really
wicked,
good.
Wicked. And they got JPP, who...
A former Giant.
Who
won, right.
But he has...
Seven and a half
he
fingers.
He did it to his quarterback.
He has seven and a half
he
fingers.
He knows seven and a half fingers, and he's got two rings
and
to
two
put
rings.
On. He could put on
he
two
put,
of those.
He could put
half.
On the one finger that's missing and make it a complete
So all he
one.
Needs is six and a half more rings.
Yeah. So, but, with Tom Brady, it's possible
but,
now.
Well, five and a half, my math is off. Anyway, my point, though, is that he was experienced enough to know that what kind of pressure... putting pressure on a quarterback does for even the greatest quarterbacks of all time. Because that's how the Giants essentially beat Brady. But what I think is the problem is Brady is to me, and this is just, it's not going to be a confrontational take at all. I feel like Brady is the most accomplished team player of all time. Saying that he's the greatest athlete of all time is preposterous. It's not even debatable.
Right.
Because like, he's not even the best athlete on his team.
Do you know that?
And he never was. There was never one point of his life in high school, college, or the NFL where he was even the best athlete on his
well,
team.
His
so
team,
we got to be a little bit more specific about you know, like how we word things, like accomplished quarterback, team player, or accomplished team player.
Yeah.
Because Serena, look at Serena.
Right.
How are you going to say he's the greatest anything of all time?
Look at the Buccaneers, right? The Bucs. What they did was, in honor of Tom Brady, they took the picture of his Columbine. Did I say it right?
Columbine.
That's combine.
Dude, what? You just totally threw a grenade on our
momentum.
Okay,
you had the combine. Sorry, the combine. That. All right, the combine
yes.
is when he's wearing no shirt
yep.
and he's all flabby. He's got that pre-dad,
that
body.
I remember that.
They all wore those shirts celebrating the Super Bowl with him, right?
Yep.
He wasn't the best looking. He wasn't. There was nothing about him that was overwhelming.
Right.
And he comes in this system. Now, here's the thing about the Patriots, and I'll say this as a Jets fan. Well-coached team. No matter who they bring in and replace it,
100%.
Well-coached team. Yep. He puts the right people in the place to teach the system,
right?
And they do it. Well-coached. Look how 20 years plus. Well coached.
Yep, no doubt.
I don't care.
And not only just well coached, the GM, I mean everybody. But everybody involved,
I mean.
No matter who they replace.
The assistant GM.
No matter who they replace, the system is flawless and it just runs the same way. And I don't doubt that they'll be back in a year or two. They're probably going to get one of these young quarterbacks. I heard they're really interested in getting bringing Mariota back. Mariota played there already. He understands what it's like to
Did
play.
Did Mariota play
Yeah, that's where, what, isn't that where?
No,
not Mariota.
Garoppolo.
Garoppolo. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Wrong Guinea. Wrong Gindaloon.
Wrong Gindaloon.
My bad. I had the wrong Gindaloon.
Wait, we're one for one right there, huh?
No, you threw a grenade on it with Columbine.
I didn't throw it.
Columbine was way worse than calling Mariota.
It wasn't a grenade. It was a dagger. It was a dagger.
That was a freaking, oh my God. All right. So anyway, that was a good point to make because you said being a Jet fan. So I want to ask your opinion on the state of how you feel the Jets are right now, and where do you think are the future? Not ours. I'm saying ours. I'm a Giants fan.
You're a Giants fan. I'm a Jets fan.
But where you think the direction?
I'll be honest. I don't think they should get rid of Darnold. I think they shore up that offensive line and give him weapons.
Okay. So first of all, I'm pulling your first Jet card right now.
Why?
You called him Darnold.
Yeah.
His name is Darnold.
It's not Darnold. It's Darnold.
Do you want to bet on that? So we're going to, and I got this. I got a perfect thing. I thought about this like for 20 years because I knew we were going to disagree. And now I got a perfect remedy to what we can bet on and what the wages will be now that we're going to be a public forum.
That's all right.
Would you like to bet on the pronunciation of his name?
Sure, absolutely.
You're saying Darnold, like the catcher that the Mets used to have.
I'm
saying
not Darnold.
You said Darnold. You didn't say Darnold. Don't
yes,
even
I
try
did.
That.
I didn't say Darnold.
We could pull the tape now, Mike. You're
Darnold.
Full of shit. We could totally pull the tape now.
Fine.
So if I'm right and you're wrong, or whoever's right, let me restate that. Whoever's right has to admit one personal thing that they would never normally admit to somebody else.
Sure, fine.
So whoever loses the bet, okay? So I'm gonna go right now and check the vernacular or however the word is.
The vernacular.
The pronunciation.
Yeah, the pronunciation. Don't check the vernacular. It's your vernacular. Your vernacular is what you find the pronunciation.
Mike will lose his first bet of 2021.
Go for it.
Stand by.
Anyway, I don't think they should get rid of Sam D.
Okay.
All right.
I like that better.
They need to shore up that offensive line. They need to give him some weapons and concentrate on defense. So they have the number two pick. Go get that kid, Devontae Smith. Or is it Devontae Smith?
Devontae Smith is bananas. That kid's.
But do you get him with the second pick, right?
I don't think so.
And then you have a lower first round pick.
I think you can get him with the second pick. Nobody's picking a receiver.
Right. I think that you get him that.
You can
low.
Definitely get. I don't think they pick him.
I think you get
with the number two pick. They go with a quarterback. If they don't, they trade down.
I think
that's
right. But I think you can get a top offensive lineman. And
100%,
Smith,
but you don't not with the
in
two
the middle.
Pick.
No, not in that. In the middle somewhere, you have 2 second rounds.
And
two
Smith
third
is
rounds.
Wicked good. Smith is going to be. I think Smith might be a top 10 pick. He's that good. I don't know if he's worthy of that
overall two
pick. I mean, that's kind of like what the Giants did with Barkley.
Okay,
and I disagreed wholeheartedly with the pick then, and I love Barkley. You know, I always support whoever my team drafts. I didn't agree with it because I thought that. You know, draft equity is worth a lot. And when you have the top five picks, wasting it on a position that may or may not be around for 7 or 8 years makes no sense to me. An offensive lineman generally lasts 10 years. A quarterback generally
now,
will last you 10 years.
Like nowadays, the longevity of used to be of offensive linemen could be like 5 years.
Right.
You know, they're a little bit better now, but. I think for the Jets, you shore up that offensive
line. You guys got a monster offensive lineman now.
Well,
they draft last year. I mean, he's phenomenal.
Yes,
and not only that, listen, the direction that the Jets are in a sense of, in my opinion, I don't know anything really much more than what I read, but a guy like Rob Salah, it seems like he's a, and I know the pronunciation of that because I heard it a million times
on one
of my favorite radio shows.
You got it right. Good for you.
Carton and Roberts, who are phenomenal on
FAN.
I'll
plug them.
Nah, they don't. Okay. I don't care. I'll do it anyway. I show that's love. Okay. Real, keeping it real. TRD, the real deal.
TRD, the real deal.
So you're going to hear a lot of my voices, and this is going to be fun. The real deal.
No, I'm sorry. Anyway, off track. Basically, I think the direction that the Giants
don't be ugly.
God hates ugly. No religion in
I
the
hate
show.
Ugly. No religion. None.
So, speaking of ugly, I'll tell you a funny story.
Daniel Beck writes to you guys, yo, fella, Sanford.
Sanford. Danny Beck.
Another story, Danny Beck.
My man,
Beck.
Strawberry.
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 Juan Salgado writes out pretty much laugh out loud.
Johnny, my man, Johnny Salgado.
Juanito.
The man, the legend, the myth, the icon.
The icon.
Johnny Salgado. Catch him at Caliente, Sirius XM. Can I plug him?
You can plug him.
My man hosts a great show on Sirius XM. Check him out.
I only understand every fifth word, so I'm good.
Yeah, you're doing pretty good then. Yeah. It only took you 25 years.
No. It's because I learned my Spanish from New Yorkans, so it's really not Spanish.
Right. They don't even know how to speak.
They don't even know how to. So
I know more Puerto Ricans that don't know how to speak Spanish than I do white people.
Yeah.
I swear to God. I'm not even lying. Some of my white friends are like,
yeah. Every time I say I know a little bit of Spanish, they go, oh, how did you learn? I say, oh, from my Puerto Rican friends. Wait, hold on. My New Yorkan friends, yeah. They're like, oh, you don't know.
No, our Puerto Rican friends.
You don't know Spanish.
They're just sitting there like, they're going,
yeah.
Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah,
yep, you don't know. Uh-huh. Anyway, Johnny, thank you.
Johnny, we love you, buddy.
Big supporter.
All of our supporters, we love you all. Thank you so much.
Got him. I'm going to have him on the show
soon.
We
hope we have you somewhat engaged so far.
Yeah.
I want to move on to, so essentially I wanted to cover like all the teams that we kind of root for.
So, leading,
you're a Jet fan.
Leading with the Jets and disappearing.
And I'm you know why I led with that? Because I feel so bad for you guys. You feel like every year you get your dick kicked in. So I just wanted to give you the floor.
Every 3 years we get our dick kicked in.
You get your dick kicked
in. It goes all the way up. Like it does, and it just sits there.
That was I jumbled
that's
my
okay.
words.
You're good.
What I'm saying is,
you're good, Papi. You're good.
Carlos Tavera writes.
Talavera.
Talavera. He writes. Sheen has ADD, driving me crazy.
Yo, first of all, I love that studio mic still calls me Shane.
Sorry. It's okay. You get to change it.
Yo, Carlos Talavera, heavy. I love you, buddy. Thank you. I do have ADD. And you got heavy D.
Carlos.
I love you, buddy. Thank you for your support. Carlos is another he's a heavy hitter. Nickname is Heavy. Played Little League with Carlos. I know him almost as long as I know Slugger. Almost the same time, yeah. Pretty much. And they grew up all pretty much same around the corner. But
he was a stud.
Played Little League with Carlos. He was a great baseball player.
Great baseball player.
And now he's a radio personality himself. He does baseball play, sports, some kind of sports show, baseball. If he would love to call in anytime and clarify what he does, that would be amazing. Anytime you want.
I don't know if he's still working. He was working.
You got
for
the
Wado.
Floor, brother. You got the floor.
Wado Radio.
Yeah.
I know.
So
what I mean,
that's
he
the one Spanish note.
That's
one,
it. That's the
one out of four that he knows.
That's it.
Wado.
One out of
Wado
four.
Radio.
Wado Radio with.
No, it's not radio. It's radio.
Carlos.
See, you already blew.
Taravera.
Dude, babble. You know what babble is?
Babble.
Aside from what I'm doing?
Yeah, it's just what
it's
you're
doing.
It's
a great website to learn how to speak another language.
Yeah.
Babble.
Did you, the advertisement. So here we're plugging Babble. Get Babble. Learn a new language.
All right,
how do
but
you
let's give our thoughts real quick, because we are on a time limit. Like, let's give our thoughts real quick about a real football team, and that would be the Big Blue, the New York
Big
Football
Blue.
Giants. Mm. Danny Jones. I'm going to give you my opinion, and then I want yours. Because
okay, I'd like to know your opinion on Jones.
I was disappointed this year, I'm not going to lie to you, okay? But I think I still saw enough with the hard throws, with the pocket presence, with he kept the turnovers at a really, like, they addressed it, and he did a great job of that. I think he made a few bad decisions, but he also, there were games he got sacked 7 times. So I think he got sacked 9 times on it. Like, the offensive line needs so much work that it's hard to really assess a quarterback with a legit open mind and give him your true assessment when the guy's on his back the whole time.
So the guy, the coach, Judge,
yes.
You think he's a good choice to lead him?
I love the head coach choice. I think Judge is, the best way to describe it is Judge is like one of those, he's not Belichick, but he's one of those guys that runs a tight ship in the sense of, Belichick comes from a Parcells camp. They hated each other. You know, if you ever see they hated each other. That whole episode, they're sitting, I mean, they respect each other. And I shouldn't say hate, maybe that's a strong word.
Marcells apologized at the end. He did, but
it wasn't like they were friends. They basically just, you know what? I'm going to stop this for, because we have a surprise phone call. Okay. And that's the real, I'm sorry, I know my ADD, Carlos, is not ADD. We got a surprise phone call that I would really love to, hopefully it's the person I'm thinking it is.
Hey, listen.
And, can we get that phone call, Mr. Studio Mike?
Caller, you're on the air.
Hello, caller, you're there?
Hey, this is Mike Durso's personal driver. How you doing?
Mike Durso's personal driver, the chauffeur.
Chauffeur's on the line.
Thank you so much for calling in, driver.
You're welcome.
So do you have any tidbits that we should know about Michael that the listeners should know about?
There's a secret you should know about this whole driving thing.
Oh my God, I'm so anxious to hear it.
The secret is, at Mike's age, I don't really want him to drive to fuck up my car.
Cheers to you.
Yeah. Oh, my God. That is probably the take of the day.
Yeah.
It's too late.
Yeah.
It's too late to start. You can't take it.
It's not starting. I know what I'm doing. I'm just go ahead.
His eyesight's going. Maybe his hearing. Okay, he can't start driving now.
You know what? That's a fair point, and I appreciate that. So I'm not going to be angry when I have to pick him up myself when you're working and not available to drive him. But ladies and gentlemen, that is, excuse me again.
Well, also,
that is the lovely Tara Quinn Durso, Michael's wife.
Also, within this whole conversation, you should tell the story about my music. How do you feel when I play my music?
Oh, he's my DJ.
Right, but what did you say how you feel when my music comes on, when I play my personal music from my list?
Sometimes it makes me angry.
Yeah, that's what it is. That's not the line.
You play classical music?
Yeah, so she plays classical music.
She actually plays classical music.
She's on the violin.
No, she's a classical musician.
I got them backwards. Yeah, that's why I was
a violin.
Yeah, yeah, her whole family does. It's amazing.
Well, no, she said that she feels cooler
right
when she drives.
That too.
Yeah, that too. She feels cooler.
Oh, you roll the windows down like when people are listening?
Nobody's listening, but I turn it up.
Hey, Tara, we have something in common because he gets me angry sometimes too, and it has nothing to do with the car radio.
No.
But I will say, he when other drivers, do something to me that is, rude, he's my guy.
I get that.
I have passenger road rage.
Yeah.
Passenger road.
See, I'm the guy that's driving. That if somebody in a passenger seat yells at me, I'm like, I don't want no scrap. You have no reason to yell at me, dummy.
Yeah, that's a good song.
Do you like when she plays Scrub when you're in wife's passenger's car?
Nobody plays Scrub.
Okay.
Nobody does.
You know what, Tara? You're a good wife, and you're an absolutely great caller, and I love you so much for calling in.
Love you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Love it.
Take care. Bye-bye.
That was awesome. So I hope I surprised you with that call. I wanted to set it up where your beautiful chauffeur bride was.
My chauffeur called and cleared up how dangerous it is for me to drive. And that's why we'll avoid Michael from driving.
For the people who don't know, Michael has never driven or owned or had a driver's license.
No, I've had a permit.
Okay, it looks like we got another call.
Oh, do we?
So we weren't going to take calls so early, but we're going to take the second call as well, and we're going to see what's going on here. Looks like we got a trend.
Call the other.
Hello, caller. You there?
Hello.
Oh, hello. I recognize this voice.
Who's this?
Oh, my God. I'm your biggest fan.
So you're the one?
Is this the Sean's house fan? This is what keeps you cool at night?
This is the person. Actually, she keeps me cool at night. She uses me as a heater when we sleep. So, yes, ladies and gentlemen,
how did she get through that snoring?
My beautiful, lovely, amazing, talented girlfriend, Patricia Martucci. Thank you for calling in, baby. I love you.
Hi, guys. Love you, too. You guys look great. Sound great.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Yeah, we can't keep the same thought going, process going on for too long, so.
So, babe, so, just add, you know, just like between me and you, and nobody else is listening. It's just me and you right now.
Nobody hears.
What advice do you have for me to like to do? What am I doing wrong? Can you give me some constructive criticism? Because I know I'm gonna hear it when I get home.
First of all, your big ass hand is all up in Mike's personal business.
Isn't he? When he reaches over and he's like, "Hey, I just want to tell you this story. Hold on a second. Wait.
Like personal space, babe. Cold.
Yo, there is no.
I'm sorry, babe.
You're apologizing to her.
She's always complaining that like when
what, my, you cut me off and you massager, put your hands to that.
When I go to massage her, that I'm pressing like ridiculously hard and I crush her hands, and I'm sorry, babe. Well, thank you for the constructive criticism. You want to give me some really like anything good?
Oh, you have anything better? He doesn't think that's enough.
No, but let me just say that I would never, ever, ever in a million years think that I'm tuning in to hear you talk more than you already do.
No, who knew that our women were funnier than us? That's hilarious, baby. Thank you so much. I will see you when I get home, and thank you for calling. I love you.
Oh, they couldn't hear the callers. On that one.
That was amazing. The first two calls of our
You gotta remember that they're live on your phones.
Gotcha.
So in order to get if they're live on your cell phones, they get in the behind the scenes effect.
Gotcha.
To get the full and experience everything in full, they have to go to either YouTube and type in the Mike and Sheen. Sean.
Mike and Sheen Show. Sheen is spelled S-E-A-N. Sheen. Mike and Sean. Mike and Sean Show. Studio Mike has a speech impediment, just so you know. No offense.
They'll search it on YouTube, and they'll find it. Or they could go to Mixed Vibes Radio on Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, whatever.
Yeah, so what happens is, I guess...
So just type in Mixed Vibes Radio on any one of the social media platforms, and you will get a real-time view of what's going on in the studio.
As well as
mixvibesradio.com's website. So we're on multiple platforms.
Jack,
we're on my phone.
Jack.
I haven't seen any of the people, so I just sorry for not shouting people out.
He couldn't see me, so he was
But what I would love to do is get back to my Giants really quick and
let's get over with the Giants story.
Just talk about sports for a little bit because we have a lot to get to.
So overall, what do you think as a fan, and you have this outlet now just to express yourself, what do you feel is missing from
Giants squad? That the same old story is the offensive line. It's the same crazy stupid story over every year. I think our defense has really turned into something super, like literally super, to the sense of it could be a championship defense with one or two pieces. It's that close.
Okay.
I think like another really good linebacker. We're strong. The defense is strong. We got some of the best. Cover men in the game, you know, and you know, guys proved it this year. I think that you know, our pass rushes would, you know, Leonard Williams stepped up, people stepped up, so we're closer than I really thought that we'd ever be at this stage. I do love Daniel Jones, and I really, really would love to see if they get a couple of linemen that can help, offensive linemen, and with a healthy Saquon Barkley and Wayne Gallman running, like, you know, we could be this is going to be the year where we'll know if Danny Jones is the real deal, because he's going to have a little
is
more.
Is this year three?
A few more weapons. This is year three.
This is year three.
You know, year one was a mess. He had no protection, no nothing. Barkley had a terrible year. Year two, he had no Barkley, and he had again a mess. New head coach, new offensive coordinator.
Right.
It's hard to win when you have that. Year three. I don't expect a playoff run. I expect to see some good progress. And again, like I said before the phone calls, we have situations where he made throws across his body, you know, that looked like they were Aaron Rodgers-esque. And please don't start and say, oh, you compared it to Aaron Rodgers. That's not what I'm doing. I'm telling you that, you know, he has certain abilities, you know, that he can do, like his athletic ability is his talent's through the roof.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So if he could put it together with his patience and pocket presence and making the right decision at the right time, I think he could really be a special quarterback. That's my opinion. If you guys agree or don't agree, call the hotline, because in the next about 20 minutes or so, we're going to start taking fielding phone calls from our friends, from some of our supporters, As many as we could get in, we'll try to get in. And yeah, I mean, how do you, and like, what's your take on how I felt about the Giants?
The Giants? Well, it's, you know, there's passion behind it, right? It's not just opinionated, it's passion. I think that's the most important thing. You know, is to have a passion in your discussions, all your discussions. Here, it's football. I have passion in my Jets, but they're disappointing all the time. It doesn't matter who owns it, doesn't matter the coach.
It's hard to be passionate about a team that's awful. Let you down so much.
And
the leadership will let you down. It's not the team, the players. If you're let down by the players, you're like, okay, I can get new players.
Yeah, if the guy's not good enough,
It starts with the owner. And that leads me to our next team that we both
most
love.
Most important. I love it. Like, I haven't, I was like kind of like distancing myself from the Knicks, you know, for a while.
And I love that you picked up where I was putting down, because we have not scripted any of this. This is just bullshit flying
off
the cuff.
They can tell.
All right. Yeah.
They don't. Nobody needs.
Can you tell that we're not scripted?
Yeah, like nobody needs to say, like, do you guys have a scramble script for the way you talk and discuss everything? Yes, we do. We have a scramble script.
But my point was, like, with the new owner, I thought maybe you would think I was thinking about Steve Cohen. And I love
no,
that.
No, not
you,
yet. We get that's.
I love
that's
that you knew that. that I was going with the Knicks, because.
Because we have a Dolan. It's just like a not a good guy, man. He's just like. He prides himself.
He's
to
a
believe,
bad guy and a worse owner.
Right, like he prides himself as being a basketball guy, right? And so for 20 years, we have been awful, absolutely awful.
Right.
Even when they had that good year with Melo and they went and they did things with Woodson and they had
Amari Stoudemire, that was exciting to
right.
watch.
But after that, it stopped.
Yeah.
And it's still him meddling. It's still him pushing the buttons and hiring these people. So I got to say this about this young team, this squad that they have out here. Even if you don't mention all the players, like, you know, with Julius Randle and, you know, drafting this kid, Obi,
Elfrid Payton.
Who's a wait? Like Mitchell Robinson.
At this point right now, playing him over quickly, now that we have Rose.
Quickly is so good.
Playing him over quickly.
Said dreams come true for Choco.
I'm so excited. That's oh, my God, I'm so excited.
What does LGFM mean?
Let's fucking go Mets.
Okay.
It should be LFGM.
Yeah, it should be LFGM.
That's Pete Alonso hashtag. Pete Alonso polar bear from the Mets. And you know what? We're excited about the New York Knicks, and we're excited about the future, and we'll get back to him if a caller wants to call about it. But because of what's going on in New York right now, and because of the announcements we had yesterday, which were very exciting announcements, and that was that the arenas and stadiums are going to start allowing 10% of capacity into games.
Yeah, I mean,
starting.
Wouldn't it be one of those guys?
So we better get those 50 tickets.
I got to get six.
For $5,000 a ticket.
Six tickets available.
I heard they're going to make the hot dogs $2,600 each just to make them feel good.
You want a beer.
It's ridiculous. So what's going on is they're going to allow 10% of the capacity of fans in any particular arena, stadium, whatever the case may be. And then depending on if the numbers don't go up, then they're going to allow 50%. And they're going to move up and hopefully, you know, that's kind of like what they're looking at to doing. I think it was 40. It wasn't 50. But regardless, it's a light at the end of the tunnel
right,
for fans who have just been, I mean, me and you are diehard fans.
And are they going to have valet parking with that a little bit amount?
No. Nobody can touch your coronavirus infested car.
There's a flare that they're going to drop in the street, and they're going to just say it's that way.
Yeah. Park it in the river. Go ahead. Yeah. But what I want to do is
I'm going to order
I feel like Boomer Esiason. I keep
I'm going to order that now.
So
get it out of the way now.
So basically, I've been putting it off for a little bit, and you know, I've been putting it off, but I announced that we will have. For those who don't know, we do a tailgate party. That's just bananas. I have an announcement for that tailgate party. For all of my fellow badass tailgate people who've been involved with us, me and Mike Durso. I never call you Mike. I don't know why I'm doing it on the radio.
That's all right. Don't.
But
just go with what you
me
feel.
And Choco for
Choco.
Me and Choco for about, I want to say together, it's probably like 15 to 16 years or so. You might have missed one or two, but I think for the most part, you've been there.
I missed a couple of them, but.
We've been doing tailgating when it was a hibachi out of the back of my Jeep. And Rich Ventura and Tony Romero were kind of the two of the guys that were.
We went with.
But we used to be College Point back in the day. The College Point guys, You know, like all the
but in the very beginning, we were on the other side of the stadium, and it was only like four or five of us.
Right.
I think it was like a couple of times it was
Tony Romero.
Mentioning full name, Sean Torres.
Sean Torres was there. Shout to Sean, who's in Florida. He's probably not listening.
He's not listening.
He's not on social media, so.
No.
But we used to call Sean. He grew sideburns that looked like shoehorns. So instead of saying Sean, we go, Sean!
Sean!
It says tailgate with the DJ.
Yeah, we had now a DJ. So we had my man Vito Vitamins. He tore it up for us 1 year for the first year was our 10-year anniversary party, if you remember. And we did, because some years we just went big. Like we had a pig there 1 year. Like we did, you know, we went pretty hard. But Chris Bones, shout to Chris Bones, the man. He basically supplied us with a DJ on a 10-year anniversary. He always helps out big time. He's always putting out, sending a lending hand. And he got Vito to, you know, Vito's a good friend. He always DJs at the bars and all the parties that we do at Rebar and local pubs. And so he had a DJ. And it was amazing that we were sitting there with grills and DJs and people with their kids. And me, I remember I looked at you and my son was there. And my son's been coming in years now. And I remember going, dude, this has turned into like, you know, we.
It's like a fucking festival.
You're looking at like 75 plus people, you know, barbecue and drinking.
We never have less than 75.
No.
I don't think we went more than like 125, but I think we're like anywhere between those two numbers.
Just like when you show up, it looks like a small group when you first peer in. But then when you start making your way through it, you're like saying hello. And
it's phenomenal.
I can't wait for this.
This year, this is part of the announcement, and I didn't even talk to Studio Mike about this. So this is how fucking raw this is going to be for everybody. We would love to do a live podcast from our next tailgate party. So wherever that tailgate party may be, we're going to do our absolute best to aim for our spot in Citi Field. So for all of you guys who attend every year, some of you guys who don't know, we're usually across the street on Roosevelt Avenue in the MTA lot. You'll have more info to find out, but we'll do our damnedest to be in that spot, depending on if they allow gatherings for 100 people.
Yeah, so that's going to be hard. People are going to probably have to park spread out and however
they
go.
Which is fine.
Or not.
We could set up two tents and be 50-50.
Or not park their cars.
But the goal is to try to get people, if you're comfortable. Obviously, people, we don't want to put anybody at risk, you know. So we're not trying to do anything in COVID stress times. This is all based on the timeline. Hopefully, it falling in the way they're anticipating it. Because they're the ones that are deciding now that they want to allow people in the stadium. So if they're going to decide that, then we can responsibly say, I want to have a gathering of 100
right.
people
well,
outside.
We'll see. We don't know their
outside.
Rules yet, so we
and
have
it's,
to wait.
It's all, you know, so again, I don't want people
we
calling
have to wait
me,
and see.
You know, saying that I'm a horrible person because I want to start a party in the middle of COVID. Like, no, stop, you know. I'm following all New York laws.
Well, you know that they're breaking up parties all over the place.
Yeah, but you know, haters.
You don't want to be that in the news.
Remember the wet
badass tailgate.
Remember the wet blankets? Remember when I talked about wet blankets? Yeah. There's so many wet blankets.
You're right. Tony Braces.
Tony Braces. That's Tony Romero, one of the OGs from the tailgate party. So, Tony, thank you for tuning in, Tony.
And tailgating.
Yeah, and Tony, Tony's, he plays, I play Call of Duty Blackout with him. He sucks, dude. I love you, Tony. I'm just kidding. No, but you do.
Just kidding. You're awful.
Like, I suck when I play with him. Yeah. When I don't play with him, I get like 7, 8, 9
You're better
kills.
At it.
When I play with him, I get like 1 kill.
He brings you down?
Yeah. And he.
You done started some shit because that's all I play.
No, oh, we're going to play. Tony, we're getting, look, Mike Studio's going to come in and you got to be better with him.
Yeah.
But thank you for tuning in, Tony. I love you. One of my closest, dearest friends from back in the Flushing days. I love you very much, brother. You're like my
long
brother.
Time. So
let's move on to, listen, just to get back to the tailgate. If we're not allowed to do it at the stadium, if there's no, you know, and I'll find out because I'll find out.
You have
to be in. I know somebody that makes those decisions or knows about the people that make those decisions.
Right.
So we'll know pretty quickly. If not, it will be at Rebar. And we did that last year. And it was a phenomenal time. We had a great, great time. We tailgated right in the front. We barbecued right in the front. The rules are very lax now with the bars being what they are at 25%. So they kind of allow us to barbecue. And last year we had a great, great time. And New York One came to interview me, actually.
I saw that.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. But anyway, the announcement is tailgate party is absolutely 100% on this year. And with all the blessings of the COVID gods that we don't have to do it at the bar. It will be at the field at our normal spot with a DJ, with food, the whole thing.
Everything's still the same. So
that is our huge announcement.
That's a huge.
One of the huge announcements I make today. We're making a couple of big announcements today. One of the other ones, since we're there, is if you could see our shirts, I think you can.
That's it.
These are the, I know, and mine is tight as shit because I had like some high ambition when I told my boy Joey iFuel.
You asked for a medium.
Joey
right?
at iFuel
was
medium.
Like, I got you.
I said, Joey, hook me up with an XL.
Get me a tank top.
I'm 255 pounds. And it's like I'm like 10 pounds of shit in a 5 pound bag right now.
Well,
but I still wanted to rock the shirt because I want to promote
you look better than that.
Our newest, one of our new endeavors, me and Joseph iFuel, is with the Pizza Gurus.
Pizza Gurus.
NYCPizzaGurus.com. For all of you Pizza Guru members that are tuning in, welcome, 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 welcome.
And we have...
I just want to announce that we will be... The website is very, it's ready, essentially.
These shirts are up.
These are our products. Two of the 11 designs we have so far. We have some local pizzerias that we are working with that we will supply their shirts.
That's great.
So the NYC Pizza Gurus is our Facebook platform, IG. You'll find us on IG. And, you know, we're 5,500 members strong. It's a tremendous group.
It's
we get a lot of
army. That's what it is.
We do. Like we get a lot of.
It's just.
Like the Ninja Turtles.
Yeah.
It's 100%.
Eat one, pull it.
It's like.
Throw it.
Think of it this way. It's like.
Crust starts hitting you for rain it down on you.
The Pizza Gurus is like 5,500 Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Yeah. Like everybody loves pizza that much.
Is it only for the people in New York?
It is not. So essentially,
there are people in there from all over.
We actually did some. We've had some international reviews, it's good that you asked that question because it started out with just a forum for me and my buddies to just like bullshit about pizza, like just talk about pizza. Let's talk about pizza.
Right. What's your opinion?
So,
of this? Got a pizza
and,
on the way.
You know, because everybody was always complaining. You know, not complaining, but arguing about who had the better stuff. So we made this little forum, and it was like 40 or 50 of us or whatever. And it just grew. And, you know, Facebook is like that. Groups take a life of their own on. Essentially, the group has grown organically from within, and it started locally. So because we're like a New York City-based group, it was an NYC Pizza Gurus, meaning that the members of our group are from New York City,
right.
And we're all pizza gurus.
Right, and you don't have to get, you don't have to get our...
It doesn't have to be a slice of pizza from New York City.
The only pizza's good from New York, and that's the end
listen,
of it.
To the newbies, don't get pissed when somebody shows a pizzeria from Albuquerque, New Mexico. This page is about knowledge of good and bad pizza. So how the hell do you know if you don't want to end up, one day you're going to end up in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and you want to know if there's a good pizzeria.
Right, and then somebody mentioned, you're
that's
like,
where we
I
come
looked up
in.
The gurus, and here they were.
Thank you very much.
Whatever.
And it's that simple. So stop being wet blankets to all you people complaining about the name.
Don't be a wet blanket.
He just reviewed a pizzeria from Lindenhurst. I don't understand what the hell that's about, because pizza was invented in Brooklyn, and the only good places that I've ever eaten from were from Brooklyn. Okay? Don't tell me Queens, and don't even try to tell me Staten Island, because that's a bunch of bullshit too, okay? And don't give me that New Haven shit, because that's just a complete crock of shit, okay? It's Brooklyn, Brooklyn, Brooklyn.
All right, I'm going to need you to take a fucking break.
All right,
now.
So listen, we got a phone call. Sorry, we got to take this. I need a break.
Shit. Man.
Carly, you're live on the air.
Hello?
Hello, hello, caller. Who's this? Your name and where are you from, please?
Oh, all right. So it's a delay. All right. It's me, Giambi, the studio zombie.
Roberto, the studio zombie. What up, Hammer?
What's up, babe?
Chilling. Yo, listen, Studio Mike.
Yo.
Do me a favor. Take all that music in the background. Put some house music. Put some freestyle music in the background. Put some instrumentals or some good music. No one wants to hear that.
Oh, look, so one studio guy to another. I love it. You don't call it. You don't call it talk to us. You call it talk to studio engineer.
Yeah, because you know how the studio guys be.
One studio guy correcting the other.
Yeah.
No doubt. I get it. So what up,
love
brother?
You
what's
guys,
on your mind, man?
Got a great show, man. That's what's up. I love it, man. I'm tuning in right now.
Thank you very much, my brother. I appreciate that.
Make sure you put extra cheese pizza on that Pizza Guru thingy. All right?
Oh, hell yeah. Extra cheese is one of the great places in Queens.
And Long Beach got that Sorrento's jump off.
Sorrento's. We will be interviewing Giancarlo Acquisenta. I think I'm pronouncing his name right. It's another Gindaloni.
But it also doesn't matter if you but don't say it right
either.
Great dude,
so. And he makes a phenomenal.
As long as you get
like
the
a
business.
Football pie. Yeah. Like he makes one of those odd oblong football pies at Sorrento's in Long Beach.
Bro, yeah, I'm telling
you. Oh, it's amazing. And I just want to shout you out.
I think he's one of. I think his grandfather was in the Sopranos or Goodfellas, one of that shit.
Oh, was he? I don't know about that.
On the wall, there's a picture of I forgot who it was.
All right. Well,
and I go, yeah, that's my grandfather. That's my grandfather. Like, oh shit, this is a real paisan.
Look at that. We just learned something. A paisan over here is a paisan.
That's my.
So listen, my man. Thank you so much for calling, bro. He's one another original tailgate member. You've been a member for many, many years with us.
Oh yeah. I'm definitely tuning in.
So I hope you're excited about the news, and we'll see you for the tailgate party at the very least, my brother.
Yeah, definitely.
Look forward to meeting him.
Thank you, brother. Thanks for calling.
Bro. Thank you for calling, baby.
Easy, you heard?
Yep.
Yeah.
All right, look at that. We're taking phone calls. We're like a real show.
It's pretty much, yeah. I mean,
I know.
It's real.
I know him a very long time. We know him a very long time. Another one of our Flushing old school friends.
I think it's, you know, amazing just the amount of people to come from Flushing that we know, Flushing, Queens, in that area.
It's insane,
and
isn't
like,
it?
But it's like Flushing, because you have different parts of Flushing, even like if you include some of that like College Point, Whitestone, Crab,
you think about the cruise,
but Flushing alone,
and I can
sections.
Again, I'm sorry, I feel like boomer size in my throat.
Sit, man,
but there's a couple, like if you think about it, how, and the boroughs are like this. Brooklyn, I'm sure, is like this, but we wouldn't know. But Queens, our part of Queens alone, the neighborhoods, and I'm guaranteeing you that we have people from all of these crews, whether one or many, that are listening right now.
Because
we go back with so many of these people for so long. Like, people always called me, like, you know, the like Switzerland or whatever, the United Nations or Steven.
His name, like, so neutral.
His nickname was Precious, which he hated, and they called me Mother Goose, which I hated because I was the voice of reason when we were teenagers. But I got along with everybody. Even a lot of I played ball, so I played against and with a lot of these dudes. So I got along with a lot of.
Well, just say, like, you have enough. Of Flushing, that there is a legit army of
it's
people.
An army, and that's
it's
what
an absolute army of people.
Between 189 Park, between 189 Park and 41st and College Point and the Latimer dudes and Bland Projects and Wastelands
and
TMR and Billmar and Franklin.
Yeah, all the way down there. 22
you know,
Park.
22 Park dudes. And like, there's so many of these people that we
Who's
grew up with.
The Burger King crew?
The Hindu O'Hara. That was a phenomenal. We used to buy all our beer. Like when we were like 17 at Hindu O'Hara, it was a great.
Yeah.
That's not offensive because Hindus are real people, right? So it's not. I'm not like saying it derogatory, but that's what we called the place because it was like an optimal.
Like he was like an Indian.
It was
Irish
an optimal.
Guy,
it was
right?
Hindu
O'Hara.
Yeah, I think he had an Indian Irish voice. It was great. But I think we have another caller. Stand
yeah,
by.
He just hung up.
We lost our caller. So call 929, back.
929. Go ahead and call back.
Call back.
Sorry about that, guys. Call back. But yeah, so with the Flushing thing, I think it's amazing because. Of the amount of people that I'm still friends with, that you're still friends with throughout the years. So, you know, like my girlfriend Trish is always saying it to me, how it's amazing how, and obviously we're union cases because we knew a lot of people. Like our park, we had 100 kids every weekend chilling every single weekend.
Yeah,
playing like, ball, some kind of ball.
Like, yeah,
so
like
that's why.
But it would be, you play a bunch of handball, football, basketball, all
it was
in the
like
same
the Olympics.
Day. Right.
Like
people
the Olympics.
Just show up and like, what are we going to do?
But you know, that being said, I think we got our caller back. Sorry about that, folks.
That's
all
right. All
right, we got
what
our
we
caller
got?
Back. Cole,
hey,
are you there?
Yo, I'm here.
Who's this?
Who's this?
This is Mark Hammer, Andre D'Souza.
This is our Rangers expert right here.
Yeah, baby.
On the scene with the New York Rangers is the Hammer.
The Hammer.
Allegedly Rangers expert.
I'll take your opinion over most. So.
Listen, you know what? This is how real we are. Our Ranger knowledge, like I know a lot more than Mike does. We're just being like, you know, as far, dude, don't give me that look. I know more than
when it comes to
Rangers.
Okay.
That part is for sure.
Okay.
How many Ranger games do you watch a year?
Oh, I told you, I've watched less the last 2 years.
All right, so anyway.
The last 2 years.
But we both thought, because we know Mark for 20-some-odd years, 30 years almost now, right? Probably about 30 years. And Mark is a very knowledgeable Ranger fan. He's been a fan as long as we, and he played hockey. We didn't play hockey. I played roller hockey at the churchyard, but Mark was playing roller hockey with them kids, same dudes. So, and as a matter of fact, Mark, did you know they closed that, they knocked down that church next to my building, the churchyard?
That was, what church was that?
That's funny. I haven't been down there in a long time.
That's the Mormon church,
The Mormon church. That was where we played hockey, though. That's where I know you played a lot of hockey, and we did, but that's one of the hockey rinks in the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Well, that's where we got our start, you know. Me and a few of the guys from 189, we got our start. But then after a while, we graduated. We went to the little yard in 189, and, you know, it just took off from there.
Right, right. Definitely, definitely. So let me ask you a question, Mark. Being that we got you on the phone, I know how I feel about the current state of the Rangers. Give me your thoughts. What are you thinking about the Rangers? How you liking what's going on?
Yeah, well, we touched on it a little bit the other day. You know, a lot of young talent. It's great to see all these young guys on the Rangers. You know, historically, the Rangers are a team that, you know, they used to buy a bunch of old veterans when they were past their prime. And, you know, they used to, you know, come in and they already shot their load and they were done, basically, when they got here.
Yeah.
So we didn't really see, other than Messier, we really didn't see any of that come to fruition. But
right. A la Gretzky and Yager, the two of the top five players of all time.
We got Herman.
Got them both when they were, like, AARP.
Yeah, but Yager did some damage, though.
Yager was doing damage at 45 years old. So
yeah, even when he was a different breed.
Yeah, that guy, he just doesn't never stop.
But the Rangers just always get these guys too late.
Yeah,
that's the problem.
But not anymore.
Yager's still playing now.
Yeah, he's playing in the Russian league, and he's doing work. I think last season he was an all-star again.
Yeah, but they also don't play hard defense over there. They
no,
don't
they
hit.
Don't. It's
they
like,
don't
yeah,
hit.
But it doesn't matter. The guy's almost 50 years old.
No, man, you play on that level, and that's the kind of skill he has, man. Yo, it's amazing that he's still doing it. You know, hockey's a physical sport. It's not like fucking, you know, baseball or handball or some shit like that. You know,
right.
You're getting hit out there. So
100%. And you got. And I think the key to those sports, like a hockey or football, is learning your, you know, place in the sport. You know what I'm saying? Like, some people could go all out when they really don't need to. You know, I think the best athletes learn how to, like, groove
to
as opposed to bring it back a little bit, harness where their strengths are.
It's
like,
and
that's why I think
like
Eli Manning, one of the strengths of Eli Manning, I know Mark's a diehard Steeler fan, so I'm not trying to poo on your time here, but Eli Manning, his best ability was availability. And he learned how to stay on the field. And, you know, and people are like, oh, I can't believe he took a dive. You know, he got down on the floor. You know what? The guy stayed healthy, and he won 2 Super Bowls for us. And we're all grateful for it all these years later, now that Danny Jones is getting hurt every other week. So not to get off the
– that was part of the whole magic with Eli. You know, he's the anti-Ben Roethlisberger. Ben Roethlisberger was a guy – taking on 2 linebackers at the same time.
Ben's another guy.
But Ben Roethlisberger is the size of a tight end playing
Ben's
quarterback.
Also, Ben's a little more special, too, I think, in a sense that...
He's just huge. As a,
not
as
only
like,
that, he took on those hits. He didn't get down. Eli at least took a dive.
Yeah.
Ben wasn't. Ben
his
was
dad a, his dad taught, Archie taught him, how, like, duck.
Yeah.
Just
no
duck.
No doubt.
Don't do anything else, just duck.
So, yeah, you know what's funny? Think about this. Imagine if Archie and Olivia Manning never met. Tom Brady would have 9 fucking Super Bowls.
Oh, man. Thank God they met.
Thank God they met. You know what, Mark? Listen, while I got you, I want to ask you another thing, okay? Because this was something that came up on Facebook with me and a couple of dudes. Brian Ty, shout out to Brian Ty. Jason Guerin, a couple of dudes that were following this. Austin Caraba, a couple of guys that were following this thread. I basically said that, and Brady is the best, the greatest accomplished team player in sports history. That's not even a debate. My question was, this was the 2 reasons, because of the Giants and Eli.
Okay.
And because of the cheating.
Okay.
Does his legacy take a hit?
No. There's too many people.
And that's what they said. They disagreed with me.
There's too many people that will say, like, I can look past those things.
Okay.
And say,
but what's
like,
your opinion, though? Because I agree. Some people can look past it. The cheating, I don't care about.
Right.
But if you don't think that Brady takes a shower or takes a shit, the times that you're sitting and thinking, which for me is usually when I'm taking a dump, right? So he's sitting on a toilet and he's just thinking about his life and how great his life is and how
I don't even think he goes.
And then
that
he goes,
far. You see,
I didn't beat the Giants. If I beat the Giants, I'd have 9.
Well, here's the thing. Apparently, when he sees Eli Manning, Eli Manning doesn't say shit.
Right.
He reaches out and he goes, you know, you beat me in 2 Super Bowls. Like, he reminds Eli, and he's like, I don't want to talk about it.
He might be cool. But, Mark, what do you think? Do you think his legacy takes a hit for losing to Eli twice?
Absolutely not. I think Eli gets a boost from it, but I don't think Brady gets any.
I don't need to know.
Accolades than he should, because I mean, let's face it. You know, for a long time, everybody was talking about Joe Montana and how great he was.
I still,
and
like I said,
Joe got five rings, and now Brady got seven. Now
right,
five.
Joe got five with no losses too. So that's the thing, you know.
Yeah, know.
But again, listen. It's
right.
To me, it's semantics.
I don't compare.
I'm not a big believer in comparing eras. I don't like the Jordan LeBron comparison. I think they're different in their own game. You can definitely call somebody the GOAT, as far. And I think this is an expression that I'm starting to hate.
But when we heard it the first time, you heard
around,
it, do you remember?
Wait, it's thrown around way too often.
It was only used for Muhammad Ali.
Right.
Like, nobody else was the GOAT.
Right, you're
100%
Muhammad
right. Ali was the GOAT.
The greatest
that was
of all
it.
Time.
It doesn't matter.
And
what
he,
you
just
did,
ask him. Hittaya.
Hittaya. Well, yeah.
Not anymore.
Yeah, obviously not now. Hey.
Hey, Muhammad.
Ali.
You
Ali.
You there?
Can you hear me?
He's not.
Nah?
No, but anyway.
Yeah, but that's the way
you
threw
you're
it
right.
around.
No, you're 100%
only Muhammad
right.
Ali.
You're 100%
just
right.
Ali.
And he deserved
he
it.
Was the GOAT. But
and he deserved
he
it.
He was the GOAT for everything.
He deserved it.
For his activism, for everything, right? And then now we were like, whoa, wait a
just
minute.
Just as being a human.
That's
like, everything
yeah,
he's
every,
done.
They were like, that's the GOAT. That GOAT right, that's a GOAT right there. Like, you can't everybody be a GOAT.
Everybody
like,
can't be a GOAT.
It can't be a
well,
GOAT.
But you know what the thing? Go ahead, Malcolm.
What do you guys sound like, man?
Who?
Do you guys sound like for real?
Who do we sound like?
Remember what, you know, fucking lunch period used to sound like at 189? And like fucking crazy kids yelling.
Just yelling at each other?
Or whatever. That's what it's like.
Well, hopefully we're a little more clear and legible than that.
I don't know.
Legible is the wrong word.
I don't think
reading.
So. It's not illegible.
Clarity.
It's not illegible. I allege that you can hear me. Allege. I'm not sure you can, but I'm alleging that you can.
No, legible is like reading.
Yeah, but legible. Dummy. And illegible.
But Mark, listen, man. Listen, let me tell you something. No, we would love for you to be our, like, you know, you don't have to commit to weekly, but we'd love for you to be a regular caller and be like our Ranger correspondent. And you're a diehard Met fan.
Yeah.
So, and you're a tailgate, you know, you've been there for just as
still
long as
still joining
a lot
us
guys.
For everything.
You're
so you're
everything.
The Ranger's eye in the sky for us.
So we want you to feel like, you know, let you know that you have an open line anytime you want to call. It's actually not open because we don't know who's calling when.
Yeah, we won't know that it's you.
It's just it's a term. It's going to be open line until you can't get through. And if you can't get through, hang up and try again. Yeah.
Keep trying.
Yeah, that's what happened before, basically.
Yeah, yeah. Listen, so you know what it is?
To Magic Jack or some shit like that. I'm like, hey, serious?
I was going to say, it's like the party line. We actually send our callers to the party line, and then they're on with 20 random people from Europe.
Yeah, I'm always down for a good party. Just don't forget to call me when the party starts.
Absolutely. But listen, you heard the news about the tailgate, so we'll definitely see you there. I'm sure I'll talk to you well, many times before that. But spread the word. Tailgate is in effect.
Spread the word. Badass tailgate's in effect.
No question about it.
And
no
we'll get some thought. We'll get some Met thoughts from you next time. We just got to cut this call a little short. But yeah, call back again, my brother. We definitely look forward to talking to you.
Absolutely.
You got it, guys, and congratulations.
Thank you.
You guys are doing a great job so far, man. Keep it up.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you.
I think this is our delivery right here.
Yes, sir.
You guys know you're my favorite white boys, right?
At least we're somebody's favorite white
somebody,
boys.
Somebody, yeah. So thank you for allowing me to be one of your favorite white
you
boys.
You know what? Speaking of white boys, I think it might be time to tell that story.
Which one?
Because it's a great story. It's a great segue. So many, many years ago, and Mark, who just hung up, he could have corroborated this because he grew up with us. Many, many, many years ago, a very famous Hall of Fame-esque rapper moved across the street from us. Right?
Pizza's outside.
He lived. Oh, pizza's here. So Mike is going to go get the pizza because we're going to do a live review of this new place, View, on 150th and across Island Parkway. And we're going to do a live view. It's a place just opened up across the street from my bar. So we never had it. We figured, you know, let's do a review of that on our podcast. But anyway, getting back while he's there, getting back to it, MC Shan, the MC Shan, you know, with some of the greatest hits of hip hop history, happened to move in to the building across the street from the park that we essentially like grew up in, and you know, Shan moved in and literally became. One of the crew, like essentially, like overnight. And again, everything, you know, if MC Shan, this ever gets back to him, he can watch this and call in anytime and corroborate our story. We basically, you know, we chilled in the park every day. He moved in. He, you know, he was young enough to still be chilling. His kid was like, you know, little Shan was about, I'd say about first grade age or so. But Shane had a studio in his apartment. And in high school, I wrote, like, you know, I was into music a little bit. Like Johnny Salgado, who's, again, an icon. He was in a freestyle group before he became famous with Proyecto Uno. But
yeah,
back in them days, I wrote a freestyle song.
Playgirl.
Playgirl. You remember that?
You're a playgirl.
I can't believe you remember that.
Forever having fun.
That is hilarious.
You're a playgirl.
Always on the run. You're a playgirl. Always getting what you want. You're a playgirl. And that's where you messed up.
Because it was you, Cookie, and Miguel.
Dude, we were going to be Cookie,
and Miguel. Chino.
Chino, rest in peace. Love you, Chino. Rest in peace. So I wrote some quick hip hop thing in high school. You know, I'm a diehard hip hop fan. I've been called the white DMX many, many times. I've been called, you know,
white DMX.
Oh my God, because of my voice.
Because of your voice.
Everlast, right? I can't even tell you how many times I've been called Everlast. But so we wrote this, you know, I had a track and I, you know, one day, you know, I was like, Shan, he's got to hear it. And Shan loved, and Mike, obviously spit in any time, but Shan loved us like
so much. So you tell the story, right?
As the next, he like literally loved us as the next white group. And listen, if I'm mistaken,
don't be surprised.
if we're mistaken at all, MC Shan, please call up and tell us that we're lying.
Yeah, he's asleep right now. He's not listening to this show.
He would call up and absolutely agree to everything we're saying.
So basically, the beginning starts is that he started to put out Snow, the it white was, reggae guy.
Well, No. So hold on, I want to cut you off. We were in the works before he discovered Snow.
Okay.
And then he was talking to us about it.
So he said to us, he was like, how about this? How about I get the guys, we produce the music, we even write the songs for you, and we'll put you on. This is what we'll, remember he was telling us the money, this is what we have to do.
I remember I spit my verse for him. Like, you know, it's a couple of verses. I spit it for him, and he was blown away. Taken by surprise that I was able to write.
He wanted to cash in on the idea of this white group, but not because it's only us. There's nobody, no other white people that would have, white Caucasian people that would have been in this group.
Right.
But he wanted to put us on. He was going to write everything, and he wanted to surround.
Well, listen, the laughability. Feel free to laugh at us if you want. I don't care.
It wasn't.
We grew up on the streets of Queens, like pretty much any other kid, different color, different skin color. And grew up on the same music, essentially. You know what I'm saying? So we had, I think, flow enough to be taken somewhat seriously.
I don't know about seriously, but...
For sure.
Just
dude,
to,
are you kidding me
hear.
With all the trash that's out there?
Right, but I mean to hear. Like, they would have definitely listened to us.
Listen to
they
me,
would
bro.
Listen to us.
Half the shit that's on the radio,
now.
If he would have... Then!
Yeah.
If he would have promoted, if he would have produced it then.
Well, what did you have back then?
Dude, anything from Lords of the Underground, I'll shit all over that.
Yeah, that's...
Come on, bro.
But like, you had...
some of the so-called, you know... Like,
they had one good song, right? But you... But
Lords of the Underground, garbage.
The white group, right? You had the Beastie Boys.
Beastie Boys were... listen, those are Hall of Fame guys.
Right, you had Third Base.
Yeah. Okay. Not Hall of Fame, but great tracks.
Okay. And then you had House of Pain.
See, the difference with us is, though, we would never... All right, so... And this is not to try be controversial, but we would never... Like, you know, like Eminem Third Base-ish. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like... You know, we ain't talking a certain way. We're not acting a certain way because we didn't grow up that way.
No.
Like, we grew up the way we grew up. And that's
to speak.
Keeping as real as it can.
Right, and having to speak.
So,
speak well when
it's,
you're
it's
in
difficult
one
when you're not a certain way in the hip-hop field. So that's why I was definitely, I had trepidation just because I'm like, that's a certain lifestyle that I'm not prepared to live because I don't do that. Listen, and it's not, no offense, you know what I'm saying? But I'm not, you know, I like smiling for pictures, okay? So I can't be a rapper.
Yeah, can't do it, can't
You know,
do it.
I don't like Hennessy.
No, I don't like Hennessy. Can't do it.
Can't be a rapper.
Can't be a rapper.
I mean, I was going to say I like White Claw, but I don't want to admit that, but I definitely
do. You ever
just
see the picture of what a man looks
White
like?
White Claw is not the worst thing in the world, okay, guys? I just figured that all out. Because I drank it with bourbon once, and it saved me. But, yeah, so
White
anyway,
Claw.
You know, MC Shan had a lot of love
Nobody
for us.
Would look at a guy who drinks
Shan,
White Claw
Shan,
as a thug.
Shan
like,
wanted, you know, Shan was thinking about it for like 2 seconds. And it was only 2 seconds, but he definitely thought about it.
He came up with it.
He was his idea.
It was his idea. He was like, I'll put
And then
you
all
on.
Of a sudden, he found Snow.
And then with the afterthought.
And then Lonely Monday Morning was released, and then Informer, and then the rest is history.
It's like a third song.
And then Shan moved out of Flushing, and I reached out to him, and he never contacted me back.
We would say, like, we regret that. Like, because even if we sucked, right? At least we would have that album out.
Oh my God, it would have been something to hang a hat on.
Yeah, like it's like that's me.
But
like,
anyway, MC Shan had me. It took me and Big Head Carlos once. Rest in peace, Big Head Carlos, my brother. Carlos, I love you in heaven. Carlos Arteatua, Big Head, rest in peace, man. So Shan had me and Carlos, and he took us to the Queensbridge Projects, okay? And he walked us through the projects.
Yeah, like, I never had that privilege.
Dude, it was wild, bro, because I'm like, you know, one of these things don't belong. Can you figure it out? Boom. You know what I'm saying? And I'm sitting there walking through, like, they're like, hey, what's your name? And I'm like, Jerome.
Yeah.
They weren't buying that
shit. Like,
they saw my white cracker.
It's like, who brings that white guy? Who brings
Irish
the white
ass, and they were like, who is this dude? But I'm just kidding. They showed me a lot of love. I literally met Cousin Bruce, if you remember that song.
Yes.
I met Cousin Bruce.
Mm-hmm.
He walked us to the center. We used to jam in the center.
You walked
you
in
You had to pay so you could enter. We didn't walk in because it wasn't open, but he showed me that whole area. And then quickly, like, Nas was basically blowing the fuck up at that point.
Yeah,
like,
what was that? Was the
just Illmatic. It was like, I think, put it this way. I knew who Nas was.
Okay.
He wasn't Nas yet, but he was, you know, and what happened was.
Well, he had that song that he did with the Large Professor first, right? What was that?
LP put him on, yeah. Large Professor, another Flushing.
What's that song?
Another Flushing Hall of Famer, LP, Large Professor.
Can't think of it. Maybe somebody will.
Another shout out I want to give to Royal Flush, my man Rommel, Royal Flush, another Flushing legend. These are hip hop icons.
He says the pizza is getting cold.
You know what? You're right. Yo, want to grab us some pizza? Let's try it. Mike's gonna serve us some pizza. Since I'm the talk a lot, I can keep you guys entertained. But yeah, so anyway, this really happened, and Snow blew up, and Snow became a platinum recording artist, and Shan made a whole lot of money, and Shan moved out. But, you know, the experiences that we had hanging with him was cool as hell, because people, like, treated us like we were celebrities. Like, every club we went to, we didn't actually go to many, many clubs, but we did a lot of Astoria Park was huge back then, like, chilling on a strip.
Yeah.
Yo, bro, we would show up at Astoria Park.
Shut down, yeah.
Oh, my God, bro. And there'd be, like, hundreds of people in groups, and, you know. And Shan just, you know, he'd get surrounded, bro. And like, you left me lonely. Yo, can you sing Left Me Lonely? Like, yo, girls would scream at him, you know, because, bro, he was an icon. And he was a good dude. And it was a lot of fun being neighbors with him. He was just a genuine dude, you know, like he was cool as hell. And it was one of those things where you're like a teenager and you're like, yo, I'm hanging out with a rap icon. Like, we played his songs on our radios all the time.
You guys want to slice?
You know, so then we're playing with him. Yeah, hell yeah. Give me
a
little pizza.
This is one plate here. So,
all
right, see
so all
if
I want is one.
Out. Yeah, but one of them's mine. Guys.
So, guys, we got pizza here. This is from the place View. This actually, like, looks a lot better than I was expecting. I don't know how it's going to taste, but it looks pretty good. No, can't front. Let me do this so you guys can see what's going on Facebook Live. Looks all right. Shout out to Ray Ty. Yeah, Main Source, Large Professor. Shout out, Ray Ty. Shade out Joe Padota, Live at the Barbecue, one of the greatest songs.
That's
baby.
It, Live at the Barbecue. Thank you very much.
No doubt.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
So shout out to every Darlene Free. Love you, baby. Thank you for checking in. I'm going to take my bite because I ain't waiting. It's bad radio. No, dead air is bad radio, right? And what's even worse is the sound of somebody chewing, but I'm doing it anyway. Okay.
There we go.
I had one bite. And
weren't you supposed to wait for?
Well, I couldn't wait for you guys because I'm starving. But I had one bite.
Here we go. Look at this. Just
it's super floppy. So it's definitely not something that stands up properly. But I got a lot of basil. And basil makes everything right, in my opinion, because I love basil. But the sauce was actually surprisingly okay. I like the sauce. It's not terrible. The crust was
Yeah. Sauce is good.
Sauce is okay.
Cheese is
kind of shitty,
extra,
right?
Extra chewy.
It's heavy. Heavy and chewy.
Thick
yeah.
and chewy.
I agree. The cheese is very chewy and like kind of thick and heavy. It feels like there's a little like heavy Parmesan underneath too that kind of saved it. I don't know.
Johnny Salgado writes, what year was that?
What year was, what are we talking about?
MC Shan.
With Shan. Yeah. Okay, wow. That's a great question, Johnny. I'm going to say I was probably 18. It was probably 17 and 18. I think it was right around the time that all that rock star nonsense went down. And I won't get into that because I don't want to delve on bad stuff. But
what was that? So 90?
It was like 92, 3, I would say. 1992, 1993 is probably my best guess. Mm. Yeah, because whatever. You know what? The best way to do it is I'll Google when Snow came out. And we'll know. Because when that album came out, Shan was living right across the street from us. And that's when he was like, yeah, I got a better white boy. He was like, yeah, you two are definitely not.
You guys are not going to make me money.
Nah, but listen, bro. Snow was, I mean, that guy's incredible. Lonely Monday Morning, to this day, is one of my favorite reggae songs of all time. To this day, Lonely Monday Morning. So it's one of the hardest beats.
So let's say he approaches you, right? And he goes, listen, I have this. I'm going to make you a star. You have to do exactly what I said, dress the way I want you to do, and everything, right? And he comes out and he gives you the prototype of Vanilla Ice. And he says, this is going to be you. He draws it up in a model and this is going to be you. Would you take Vanilla Ice's career? Because the first 3 years, there's a lot of people that thought he was like, there's a lot of white people that were new to hip hop, right? That thought he was their savior.
Which Vanilla Ice career? The one, the rap career, or the one that he's fixing career. Houses now?
No, not that. No, he fixes houses and does metal. That's now.
I wouldn't mind that career.
But that's a different.
No, so I would probably take, as corny as it was,
hundreds of millions.
And
of
I think
dollars.
I watched that video with you guys with that whole dance move, we kind of liked the dance move for like 10 seconds, and then we realized how cheesy and garbage
it was. I was never a fan of him.
That being said, with all his money, no Suge Knight, I would probably do Vanilla Ice's life. No Suge Knight. But if Suge Knight's involved, ain't hanging me upside down.
No.
I'm way too fat for that.
Yeah.
he would drop me. I don't care.
I'm too light.
How strong
I'll just
he is.
Slowly glide away down to the bottom.
You'll float away like a
right.
leaf.
It'd be like, you dropped me. I'm good. Yeah. So that's that whole MC Hammer, like Vanilla Ice. And so would you take Vanilla Ice's career pre? Yeah, I'd say like looking back and you think he made a lot of money.
He was on every.
And that show that he does where he fixes the houses, it started because every city he went to, he would buy a house and he would just own it. And when the rapping kind of dried out, he fell back on the houses that he had.
Right.
And he'd make a ton of, so he started to fix them up.
Smart man.
To sell them and
turned it into a lucrative business.
Yeah.
He's not as dumb as he sounds, that's for sure. Because when he talks, word to your mother.
Everything.
Who says that? Who says that with a haircut
that? He does. He still keeps the.
He still got the stripes in his eyebrow.
He still got the stripe in his eyebrow.
Stupid asshole.
Yeah, he does.
I mean, I'm just kidding. Vanilla Ice is great. Yeah. We don't want to badmouth nobody. Snow, Lonely Monday Morning. The video was made. excuse me. It looks like the song was made in 1993. So I was right. Either 92 or 93 was basically when Shan was living on Sanford Avenue in Flushing, Queens, across the street from the infamous 189 Park.
189
where
legends were made.
Where legends were made. And definitely not being made nowadays. That's for sure.
It's tennis and parking now.
Derek, I love you, Derek. Crazy Derek, my man. I love you to death. Thanks for tuning in. Sue Butler, love you. I lived with Sue for many years. She was my landlady, and she's one of the best people I've ever met in my life, and I love you. Rest in peace, Junior. We miss you very much. Darlene again saying hello. My man Joey, check out your logo. It's on our feed. Showing you mad love for everything you do for us, Joey. You're the man.
Thank you.
So listen, I wanted to mention some other small businesses while I can really quick. really no segue into it, but guys, we just need to support each other, you know, in a sense of the government is not caring about us. And I'm not doing politics, but the government's not caring really as much as they need to. So we have to take care of each other. This show is going
to
be
about
showing love and just paying it forward and being supportive of each other. Having a bunch of different opinions is kind of what makes this country great. So when you don't agree with us, we want you to tell us. When you do, we want you to tell us. But we also would really, really love it if you showed support to the businesses that we mentioned. Some of these people are just, you know, regular people struggling to get along, and we need to keep these businesses alive, man. Like, this is a do or die moment for a lot of these people. A lot of, like me, myself as a business owner, small business owner, as you know, as small as it is, albeit, we don't know the future of what's going on. It's scary. So a lot of these people need to be supported and supportive. And if you can, please go out, Spend a couple of dollars locally. Buy a beer somewhere. Buy flowers at the local florist. Don't call 1-800-FLOWERS because you're lazy. If you're scared to going out and if you're a high risk, then you have to do everything, you know, remotely. But every single business locally has a website and has a way of getting stuff.
Well, so even if you go the places that you go to get your food, when you order Seamless, if you call them directly, they have their own delivery service. Right. They have their own crew.
Right.
So instead of paying these fees to someone else, call them directly and get them.
There's a delivery service for everything nowadays.
Right, but you call them directly, they're delivering themselves.
Right, no, right. That because of what's going on. They have their own crew
100%. Instead of Uber Eats or
so
Seamless.
So just call the businesses
out
directly. Call them first. Let's see what, you know, let's keep Queens alive. Let's keep New York alive. Let's keep the United States of America alive because, you know,
with Queens, work our way
through
New
always
York,
starts. It always starts from within. We'll but, you know, in, but we're, you know.
But I think it's the most important thing is that, yeah, like, you know, we can go out. And, you know, if you can drive up and order your food and to take it, you know, to take it with you instead of calling up the delivery service,
right,
is even better.
It is.
Because
you're giving more money directly.
More money
but
directly.
But listen, you know, also just keep in mind also, folks, that, you know, we are in a position where we can definitely make a difference because the amount of money that's being spent right now online is, it's ludicrous. And it's just, you could see it by how some of these businesses are doing really so well. So, you know, just keep that in mind. You know, like, you know, if you get stimulus money and you have to pay your rent, then you do that. But if it's extra money, spend it locally. You know,
if you're going to spend, don't just spend
it. If you're going
to
spend, I'm not saying just spend. So, you know, let's just be as supportive as we can, and that's the main thing. I would love to mention one of my dearest friends and my partner for a lot of years on Bell Boulevard, and his two partners. At JD's Saloon.
JD's is a local
pub in Bayside. It's 208-11 35th Avenue. They have a Facebook page, JD's Saloon. It's just another great small local place where you can go shoot a game of pool when they lift those restrictions. And you can go have a drink and watch a game with some great bartenders and some really good company. They make tremendous hot dogs. No, but honestly, God, I mean, they got some legendary bartenders up there. They are Rob Saunders and Dennis DeMacy are Larry's partners. My buddy Larry's partners.
Lorenzo.
Larry's one of my dearest friends. You know, we've become brothers over the years.
Larry.
And I just want to show all those guys love. They're three of the nicest guys you ever meet. So go in there, have a beer. Obviously, restrictions are still in place, guys. So, you know, if 20,000 people show up, it's going to be a little different. But obviously, you know, any little bit helps. So go show some small business some love, and everybody would greatly appreciate it. That's for sure. 100%.
100%.
You have anybody that you are looking to get out there, to word out there?
Yeah, it's like, go to Rebar.
Yeah,
I mean,
well,
go to
Rebar.
If you're just going to have a drink, go to
Rebar. I appreciate
that.
Thank you, buddy.
I mean, that's all. I mean,
Rebar is, you know, I'm very proud in a sense that it was a bar that, you know, not a lot of people know. The history wasn't really good over the years. It kind of got really, you know, it kind of got run down in a sense of, like, people, you know, shitty clients and, I mean, customers and fights and all this other garbage.
Well, yeah,
but
like, it had a very young crowd and element.
Young element.
Going, and it was a, you know,
drug-addicted element.
Drunk-addicted, young, stupid element.
But we were able to turn that crowd around, and I'm really happy with, like,
to an older, angry element,
right,
that comes in there now.
But, so, you know,
at least they're older,
an element that's fun to, like, watch, drink, and have, you know, shoot a game of pool again with, you know. Neither JD's or Rebar has kitchens, so we do our best to, like, supply food and,
little,
you know, do our best to, like, keep people hungry, because the New York law is you got to serve food.
Right.
But
so to be open, you have to serve food. You have those little pizzas that you get.
We have pizza ovens.
Up.
We actually get pizza from the Pizza Network in Oakdale, Long Island, which is phenomenal. I don't know how the hell they do it. They send us the pizza fresh, okay? And this is another thing for the gurus. They send the pizza fresh. The pizza comes, and we put it in the, you know, freezer just so we can maintain it. You know what I mean? But when we're ready to serve it, we put it in the oven for 10 minutes. And, Mike, am I lying? You tell me. It comes out like the freshest pizza you've ever had. It's a little mini pizza. They're phenomenal.
For a pizza that you get at a bar, it's pretty good.
Right.
It was really good, but it's, again, you're...
For a pizza you're getting at a bar that's not made fresh at the
bar. Right,
like,
yeah,
that's what I'm saying.
That's like...
If we had a pizza oven, if we had a freaking, you know, if I get an uni in the backyard, you know, which I'm buying an uni oven for my house,
mm-hmm,
but if I did an uni oven in the backyard, then obviously it's going to taste a little bit more authentic because you're using, you know, fresh dough. And, but what I'm saying is everything's coming fresh from the Pizza Network. So anyway, we're not to harp on that too much, but JD's and Rebar all have the Pizza Network. Nono's Bar and Grill also has a Pizza Network.
So Nono's Lounge, if now that the
I said Nono's Bar and Grill, but it's Nono's Lounge.
Nono's Lounge. So now that the Super Bowl's over and you want a more mature place to go, the lounge is it's got the nice patio in the back. It's an adult crowd. It's more mature.
Great crowd. It's always been one of the more mature crowds.
More,
on Bell,
yeah, like
as far as Bell's concerned,
laid back and less chaotic than the other places.
Nono's is 4223 Bell Boulevard. They are nonoslounge.com is their website, and they do have Facebook and Instagram pages as well.
Just tell them that you come from the Mike and Sean show, and you'll get. Not get 10% off. You will not.
No, it's actually, you won't get 10% off. You get 15%
off.
Yeah,
you'll get.
But you have to.
You have to mention the Mike and Sean show.
Mike and Sean podcast, and that's tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
Between 5 and 5:15.
Yeah.
No, I'm just kidding. Anytime tomorrow, just go in there and mention
our show. They'll take care of you.
And they will definitely take care of you. That's a great great place. Danny Bell, Jimmy Cody, Marky Love, another great trio of owners.
And great friends.
Yeah. So a lot of these guys I know forever, and we all bartended at the same
time.
And now everybody owns it. Now we all own bars.
You just keep people and keep sending them to each other's bars.
It,
it's like, hey,
show
go have
love.
A drink there.
Show
oh,
love.
I don't want to go yet.
Listen,
no, you got to go.
There's no competition, bro. There's so many drinkers.
There shouldn't be.
No.
Right.
Makes no sense to compete. But.
Because after COVID, we found out that everybody's an alcoholic anyway. So now that they've all prepared those, you know, those livers for good drinking and.
Sorry, I'm stepping on your words again.
It's okay, man.
You seem like you're stuck. I wanted to help you.
Nah, it's all right. I didn't need help. You do a good job of bigfooting the shit out of it, you know. Yeah, you're like, I don't know anymore. I don't know. When I go to speak, I don't know. The minute, like, your mouth opens up and there's a vowel pops out, and so
listen,
it's going to take over.
What do you think? Whispers comes from a...
Yeah, it doesn't. I know where it comes from. I know exactly where it comes
from. So, everybody,
from.
I had to go on Facebook Live really quick because I wanted to show some love to another small business owner, but I have the info on my phone. So just stand by with that. But in the meantime, I want to talk more about the Steve Cohen situation with the Mets.
So there's some information.
We really didn't harp on that.
Yes, but here's the thing. Because you were saying that it was like, you know, the story comes out. He's not as innocent as it's laid out.
Okay.
So the problem with it was the main company that lost a lot of money in the backlash after that dumping.
Which was the guy that used to work for him that owned
right,
his
own, so he bailed him out.
Right.
So Billy...
Well, he didn't bail... Oh, so he did bail him out. That's
the
right word.
So
he lent him...
Yeah.
He bought into his company.
So billionaires only lend money to billionaires.
All right, 100%.
So there's not. It's not like he's going
and
to
he,
us
and
like...
And he had a relationship. He worked for
right,
him.
Like they were friends, but they only bail out each other.
Right.
So the backlash was like, you should let them fail. And
right.
He was like, no, I don't have to.
Yeah, but that's not
but
his...
That's, yeah, but the main problem, that isn't the main problem.
No, but see, the backlash, let me just stop you there, because that backlash, first of all, a lot of the backlash came from Portnoy, okay? And Portnoy just, without having any kind of real info, just attacked Steve Cohen. And a lot of it was because Cohen bailed out somebody who worked for him. The guy lost whatever the number was.
Billions of dollars.
I heard between 12 and 17 billion,
whatever
the number was, okay?
Yeah.
Because he was betting against GameStop.
Right.
And then the buyers bought it out and blah, blah, blah. We all know the story, okay? Which was a brilliant move as far as I'm concerned. They didn't break laws, and some people lost money.
But it was because of Robin Hood blocking.
I wouldn't say brilliant. They blocked them from selling.
Right.
But I wouldn't say brilliant, but it's good to see sometimes it gets stuck to
But it did happen. So what happened was a stock dropped back down.
Right. And those people get stuck with a bad stock.
Yeah, except for this company.
Right.
Now the problem with
Cohen, definitely hurts a small guy in the long run.
Cohen, when you look at his back companies, basically he was fined and for like fraud and a lot of like $1 billion.
Which was a story that everybody knew about.
Right.
The securities and fraud.
But that's what they were saying. You have
securities exchange fund. But
right.
Dude, that happens with all of these companies.
Right. But what I'm saying is they're saying you clearly were frauding people once. We believe you're frauding
again.
Okay.
So, all right. So again, now you have a situation where a company lost money, but the company that lost money did not fraud anybody. Okay, so let's be clear about that. Robinhood did the frauding.
Right, and so he called them out and said...
We're talking like idiots because it's not did the frauding. But
he did the frauding.
Robinhood, he did the frauding.
He did the frauding.
So,
and,
they said, are they reading these comments?
I'm not on Facebook Live there.
No, on YouTube. I had you logged in right here.
Oh, I went off of it.
They're like, shut.
Yeah, they're reading the comments, guys.
Oh, good.
I'm also letting them know behind the scenes, but yeah, they are reading the comments.
Well, I'm sorry if I'm not reading them quick enough, guys, because we're trying to chat in this little 2-hour show, but we will be getting to a lot of your comments. But to back to that, what I'm saying is Robin Hood did the cheating. Robin Hood did the bullshit, right?
Right.
And now, so the guy who lost the money, the victim of this, if you want to call him a victim, because he's a billionaire scumbag, but the victim of this happened to work for the Mets owner.
At some point, the Mets owner
and another guy who he happens to be very good friends with each came up with $1 billion to give to this guy who lost all this money.
Correct.
They bought into his company. They didn't just give him money. It wasn't a bailout.
Right, but it was a loan with...
to keep him alive. So he needed $2 billion to keep his company relevant.
Okay.
So now they gave him $2 billion
to
keep his company relevant.
But could you see why somebody would be like annoyed at it?
No, this is why...
Because they're saying let him sit.
I can't see why, because I'm going to tell you why. Because all you got to do is go on your social media, your Google, I don't even use Google, DuckDuckGo, or any search platforms, and do your research.
Right,
and you'll know that Cohen did nothing wrong. But instead, he's getting death threats, and his wife is getting death threats on social media.
Right,
now, this is the second time this is the second time that a Portnoy accusation has led to death threats.
Right, but he's also the guy who did his pizza show.
Right,
and
we were called frauds for doing something similar. Meanwhile, we're from New York that talks about New York pizza.
Right. But anyway.
But whatever. The point is, this guy attacked him. He went after him
with
no evidence. And now people are calling Cohen.
They jump on the wagon.
Dude, death threat. The people that Portnoy's followers, they're beyond like
everybody's got a cult. He's got a cult.
And he could easily step in and be like, guys, stop. You know, because they listen, they hang on every word the guy says. So it's not like he doesn't have control over the masses. And it happened, if you don't believe me, watch the real sports story. It happened with Aaron Andrews. It was a whole story. There's ways to be, you know, listen, I respect the hell out of the guy. He built a freaking empire from talking about sports or pop culture. Kind of like what we're doing.
Yeah.
It's amazing how I started the pizza group and now the podcast. And I'm like sitting here trying to act like I'm not a Portnoy fucking robot. But I'm a dude from Queens that finally had the ability to sit in front of a microphone and finally had the wherewithal because I'm not working like a slave so that I could create little...
Right, but your mind is a little bit freer. The stuff that the ideas are
I can do
in,
what I
like,
want.
Oh, I want to share them.
It just so happened that the timing fell out where I could do what I want
it's
right
perfect.
Now.
It's perfect.
So, you know, so for all of you people that want to attack me and say like, oh, you're a Portnoy robot.
Attack
like, come at me, baby. Because you could talk good or you could talk bad, but just keep talking about me. Mike, come on. That's your time to talk.
That laugh, though, it stopped me.
Wasn't
it stopped
good.
Me in my tracks. It stopped me in my tracks. Like, I don't think I can recover from that one. Oh, there it is. That's sexy. That sexy laugh. Yeah.
That one's good. You like that one?
Yeah, I like that.
I got voices.
No, you know, but...
Straight out of Moscow. Yes, Brazos, Mazel, Mazel.
That makes sisters think I love it.
Sisters think I love it.
Yes.
Dangerous, motherfucker is hell.
Yes,
if I ever get caught, make bail.
I don't give fuck. That's what I tell them.
That's straight out of Moscow.
Straight out of Moscow.
We actually wrote that when we were the Mike and Sean rap podcast.
it was a recorder.
So
we
now
pressed the button
you guys just heard why MC Shan didn't sign us.
Yeah. You guys suck. But back to that, it's like... He created the show on like guy dick jokes and all that other stuff on there, right? And he made it, and he had to clean it up a little bit, and he cleaned up a little bit, and he made it more important. And so, to shitting on that idea, even though the one thing that he did was wrong, he put that format out there. He did it on his show. He knew he had people that were going to follow him. He knew that he had a cult that would go and get revenge because he said charge, and they did.
Right. No,
you know?
And I get, listen, I get
and
that.
And they went that.
And I,
know?
Again, I don't want to, it's not going to be a bashing show on that
but
end.
Let me,
but
let me
I got
bring
it,
that, hold on.
The main show of this, the main thing about this goal of the show is I'm going to like call out my opinion on certain
but
stupid
that's
things.
Right.
And the fact that he was getting attacked at the level he was getting attacked for something he didn't do wrong.
Right.
And then it's always same old match, the drama. The people are creating the drama. Again, this is where fake news. This is where people don't want to play in New York because there's too many stupid idiots in New York.
Right, and he's not even from New York. But here's the other thing, too.
Stop being an idiot, you New Yorkers.
New Yorkers, you stupid.
Yeah, I'm a New Yorker. And, you know, it's a prerequisite to be a fucking moron, all right?
Yes, you know what's...
When I walk across the street and I'm walking, I hate all people in cars. And when I'm driving the car, I hate all people who walk. It's amazing. It's like a civil war of stupidity.
I hate rain. I hate snow. I hate the wind. I hate tourists.
Get out of my way. I'm on my way to work.
Fuck you, lady. Get out of my way. I'm on my way to work.
You know what? F you.
All right. Wow.
So we're that,
see? Spit out your rap song for
holy
back in the day.
Spit out my rap song. Somebody requested that?
No.
Somebody's requested it?
No.
I could do that.
No.
Can you give me like a something better than what's in the background now? Can
no,
you give me something? Shut
no,
up. Like,
no.
I can definitely do that if you could give me like a something better. If you could work on that.
When I'm alone in my room, sometimes I stare at the wall. And in the back of my mind, I hear my conscience call.
Telling me I need a girl who's as sweet as a dove. For the first time in my life, I see I need love. There I was, giggling about the games that I had saved many hearts. And I ain't saying no names. Then the thoughts occurred. Teardrops made my eyes curl. Or eyes burn.
Or something.
Something like that. That was a great LL. Listen, first of all, let's get on this real quick.
Yeah.
I don't care. People call him corny, crossover, whatever, because of the rat. Because of the, I don't know. But LL, he doesn't get nearly the amount of props he deserves for being one of the icons of Queens. When I saw a recent top five, he wasn't even a top 10, and that to me was pathetic. Because if you buy his all world album,
five, there wasn't a top 10.
No, but he wasn't in the top 10.
No, top five.
He wasn't in the five or the 10. No, the list went bigger. I said it wrong. Sorry, he wasn't in the top 10 of the top five. Anyway. Ooh, I could probably do this.
Let me see if
I can. All right, let me try this. I'm gonna try it, all right? I'm gonna try it. Here we go. I wrote this in high school in 1990. All right, here we go. I'm the biggest man in charge, so welcome to my world. I never liked a hump, but yo, I track down your girl, cause yo, I come and steal your stunt. You couldn't shoot me if you want. Cause if I wanna get blasted, I'll just puff on a blunt with your girlie that I jack, cause I want my baby back. Ribs to be cooked, baby bibs to be hooked. Check it, look, I'm just another name on the block. Got faith in my man, and he goes by Choco Rock, so don't lock jaw on what you saw, cause I'm heavy. Two and a little chain, so get that booty ready. I cut it up with Freddy with my cock, not a machete. My rhymes are mad energized, so fuck ever ready. But what you got to say to that, chump? I kicked the verse, I kicked the rhyme, I kicked the funk, G. So fuck a referee when he called a foul on me. I had to slam a nigga when he went for the three-pointer. Joiner, get a sheet of paper, twist it up and lick it, stick it in my ear for later. Yo, I never ran a caper, but I got a little mob. Always do the job and never eat like a slob. So peace to all my peeps and lick my nuts to all you creeps. Graduated high school, even though I'm from the streets. At the ocean, use a lotion to avoid a burning back. Cause yo, I'm not the one, I'm a star, not a sun. And that was that. That is, and I apologize for the use of the N-word, but that was the culture. And I didn't edit it because somebody just asked me to come off the top of my head with that. I wrote that in 1990.
Well, damn, he held it down.
Yo, it was produced pretty, it was actually produced.
Well, you imagine the 1990 production. It's got to fit no, what no, he no, with
no.
the words.
It was actually produced. It was produced in 2002. A friend of mine at when I worked for All Mobile Video, when I worked in the TV production company, my boss at the time was a musician, a rock musician. Mm. He knew nothing about hip hop. And he was making an independent movie with a friend of his. And they needed a rap track. And everything was licensed and they couldn't use anything. So he's like, dude, I need you to write me a rap song. And I'm like, bro, I'm writing a rap song. And it was like a Lorena Bobbitt kind of movie where a wife caught a husband cheating and she cut off his pee-pee. Ooh. But then the movie was about revenge on the wife. So it was kind of like a weird take. Anyway, they needed a rap song for a strip club scene, and he gave me this crazy track that he produced, and it was like very West Coasty, but it was really dope, you know. And you heard it a million times, and yes. Whatever, you can make all the faces you want.
I'm not making the faces other than to say that.
Unfortunately, I lost that disc in Hurricane Sandy in my truck, so I don't have any proof of that.
And then I threw it back in the ocean.
They write online. Well, we got a lot of comments, guys.
I'm sure it is. I just opened myself up for abuse. I don't care. So listen, I told you, full transparency, man. I'm a multi-talented mother effer.
Well,
Roberto Garcia writes, told you studio might change the background music.
Jobby, my man. That's great.
James Moore writes, drama sells for idiots. Idiots are wet blankets. Melissa Gonzalez, we see you. She's writing yes.
Oh, I love it.
James Moore writes, I need drugs. Laughing out loud.
You ain't the only one, James.
Yeah.
You know, weed's not a drug, so let me just get that clear. Weed is not a drug.
It's medicinal.
It's a gift from God.
God.
It's a gift.
It grows.
He actually wrapped it with like green leaves.
Yeah. You could sprinkle this on
made
your
it
food.
Fancy for us. But thank you guys. I appreciate the good feedback. And for all the guys with the bad feedback,
keep it up. Thank you.
Screw you.
Bring it. Bring it.
Listen, I
toast and roast you, buddy.
I'm here. I'm telling you, I'm here to I'm gonna be as transparent as I can. I'm gonna try to keep away from some personal stuff if I, you know, if people ask me, because a lot of my story is kind of out there with, you know. But as far as like, I'm gonna be transparent. You ask me questions, I'll answer them. You know what I'm saying? And like, listen, I'm not afraid of anything. I ain't hiding from shit.
I'll tell you something funny. Something I read about Tom Brady. It was like he gets amused by people with death threats and talking about physical violence on him, but he draws the line at talking shit about his dog.
Oh, dude. Everything about him is just
like,
annoying.
You see, like, what
I'm kind of happy they did win, because it makes the Giants seem that much more. Why? I really am. I was rooting for Mahomes because he's a diehard Met fan. He's father plays for the Mets.
Yes, but I mean, just like he's the
but I'm happy because just in the sense that
he's just amused by death threats. He like these people like, I'm going to do harm to you.
He's really adorable.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that. You're gonna hurt me.
Yeah.
You're gonna run me over.
But you're talking about my dog. His dog probably cost like some ludicrous amount of money.
He threw the dog with the trophy from one boat to the other.
I didn't see the dog in the trophy.
He threw the trophy.
That was pretty funny.
I was like, yeah.
He looked like he was hammered in that picture.
Well, when they drag him out. But look, that's what happens, right? You have fun.
That's pretty funny.
You know, that's what it's all about. You work that hard to fight and play for a championship. It's one game. It's not a best out of seven. You fight for that one game. You put it all on the line. And
That's what real champions. And that's why I think the Bucks won, because they had guys like Brady, obviously, who's the best of winning, but JPP, and you know, guys who won, guys who know what it takes.
But they also had,
and you need one guy on each side of the ball, and that's what they proved, because all they were in Mahomes' face every play, dude. Except and Mahomes made some throws.
That one where he's like almost laying on the floor.
Bananas.
And
that kid, Aaron Rodgers, to me, in my opinion, is the greatest quarterback of all time. And just in the sense of the eyeball factor, just in the sense
you
of
put
what
him
he
over,
can
say
do,
a guy like Marino that
I
you're
do,
able
and
to
I
see?
I think Marino's top three in my as far as physical ability.
But then they would say like, yeah, there's a
it's,
top.
To me, the top three physically and greatest like talent wise were Marino, Elway, and
then
Bert,
you but you're Aaron rated Rodgers. But you're also rated by championships, right?
But, and
so
I
if
do.
You don't win championships.
I don't rate.
Like,
I don't rate greatest athletic quarterbacks by championships. I just rate them by how.
So
I
you have different categories.
Because Marino's
categories.
Obviously never won.
Right.
Top
no
three.
Championships.
But Mahomes has the ability to be better than all three of those guys combined. That's how good that kid is. He's scary good, bro. He's scary good. He recognizes shit before, you know, like a kid his age should.
But they obviously couldn't protect
him.
Well,
no, couldn't protect him. There was nothing he could do. He did every. Yeah. Listen, how many drops were in that game? Three huge drops, two absolutely disgusting calls. And I'm not saying they would have won, because they definitely wouldn't have. But the game would have been a lot more interesting had, you know, two of those catches been made, one for an end for a touchdown, which would have changed the whole completion of the complexion of the game in the beginning. You know what I'm saying? But I think overall, the talent factor on him is ridiculous. It's through the roof. And that was, you know, led to another thing when I said, you know, if he won, he would be on the heels of Brady's being the GOAT. And people laughed at it. You know, Brian Ty again, Mr. Know-It-All.
What about, you mean Mahomes?
Left me out of the building.
If Mahomes won?
Shout to Brian Ty.
If Mahomes won, is what you're saying?
If Mahomes won, I said he'd be fast on the track of because he would have won.
But it's the longevity.
He would have
this
won
is what you were saying about 100%. Calling him the greatest of all time.
See, I'm only
as a phrase, but you're not to, like. Say,
I'm only speaking on the sense of him playing healthy like Brady did for.
But it's the
Brady
if.
Missed one
it's
year in
if.
20.
Look at Odell Beckham, right?
Or missed
oh
two
my
years
God,
in 20.
He got better numbers than Rice. He's this, that. All
no, but Mike, listen,
things.
I'll never argue that. Football's a game of injury. I'm argue anytime I make who can
I
be
mean,
better,
but the
it's
modern,
if they were healthy.
But
healthy,
modern day.
A healthy Brady against a healthy Mahomes.
Modern day.
20 years against 20 years.
A guy has a couple of good years and they go,
it's too
oh
early
my God,
to tell, obviously.
He's going to be the greatest of all time. He's on pace to shatter all these records. And then what happens 5 years later? You don't hear shit from him. You're just going to whiff of it.
Yeah.
You know, a guy like Aaron Rodgers has great teams, but you know, they always say, imagine him on another one.
Right.
Same thing, look at Elway. Elway, before he won those two Super Bowls.
But he was, I mean, listen, as a Giant fan, dude,
he was winless before that.
Yeah, but I know. And I remember why he lost that game against the Giants. Because he played against the greatest defensive line after the Chicago line. The Giant, that line in 86 was fucking bananas, dude. Yeah, and then the linebackers with LT, and that defense was just crazy.
Leonard.
Roberto Garcia writes, is Hector going to be on the grill and tailgate?
Hector will be on the grill.
On the grill.
For tailgate 21.
It's confirmed.
For all you people who are worried, don't worry. Hector Garcia will be
on
the grill.
Stop the fear.
Absolutely.
Hector's on the grill.
Fear not.
James Moore says, love the show, guys. Love the show, boys. Isis 89 writes, screw Brady.
Screw Brady. I agree with that.
Yeah.
He also writes Defense Wins Chips.
No doubt.
Juan Salgado writes, congrats, bros. MC Shen, yes. Makes sense. I was already out on tour and missed them days.
Ah, yes. Johnny Salgado, who, again, we mentioned earlier, is our probably, not probably, he's our most famous friend. We all
he's
grew up.
He's our famous
he
friend.
He is our famous. He was part of a legendary Latino group called Proyecto Uno. They are super renowned. What's the word I'm looking for?
Renowned.
They got recently admitted to the Smithsonian, correct?
Yeah.
So the first Latin pop, first Latin group of all time inducted into the Smithsonian. I might be wrong on some details.
Well, when we have him in here,
I wish I was more prepared. But
clean it up.
Because
we'll
next
it up.
Week, Johnny Salgado will be live in studio.
And you know who that's news to? Johnny Salgado.
Johnny. Johnny, guess what?
You're on the show next week.
You're busy next week.
Yeah.
So we just
Thursday.
We just
7 to 9.
We just basically booked our most
Johnny
famous
Salgado
friend.
Johnny Salgado will be on the show
by telling him on the air. See you next week, buddy.
Eastside Johnny Walker writes, "Let's go Jets."
Let's go Jets. 100%. They're gonna get better at it. Gangrene's gonna get better.
You're never
gonna
hear me say that there, Eastside Johnny.
Don't have to.
Big Blue. True and true.
Listen, gangrene is going to kill you. Big Blue is
how do
you
name
girlfriend
how do you,
you
name your team after a debilitating disease?
Because we kill.
How is your
we
nickname?
Kill our
no,
fans.
You kill yourselves and
we
your
kill
fans.
We kill our fans. We don't
gangrene.
Kill ourselves.
I hear
we don't
gangrene.
We kill our the fans.
When I hear gangrene, I think of body parts falling off.
Well, I think of death. That's
like I smell death actually.
Yeah, it's that's.
So it looks like we only have a few minutes left of our show. We have about 7 minutes. Well, actually, we started 3 minutes late, so we'll give you a full 10 minutes left. I really want to just start by saying, just so we can round it up, I really want to say thank you to my partner and one of my closest boys for the last 35 years, Michael Chocolate Dersel.
If you didn't say it that way, it would sound.
I can't be
it would
serious,
sound
though.
Like it was authentic, but now authentic. I don't believe you.
You're my boy, and I love you for doing this with me, and I love you for putting this together because this was kind of your baby, really. You know, you knew that I was great with my voice. And
I knew that I wouldn't get a word.
You knew
in.
The you knew the greatness was in your hands.
I knew that no matter what I had to say, I would just have no
just
chance
need,
of saying.
You
it.
Needed to direct the greatness, and thank you for that.
Well, I mean.
Please tell the guys that ISIS 89 is Tony Braces.
ISIS 89.
Yes.
I know who Tony Braces is.
Yes,
thanks,
we
Tony.
Know.
So you know.
ISIS.
Thank you,
man.
ISIS.
Thank you, ISIS.
Jeez.
Somebody wants to be recognized.
Tony
Romero, Braces, ISIS 189.
Tony, send me your social security card. I'll put that number up there, too.
You're... Roberto Garcia writes his life partner.
He is my life partner.
Yeah.
I never penetration though, right?
I was no, not that I'm aware of.
It was always over the close.
Over the close.
The Lara family. The Lara family.
Stevie DL.
Stevie DL.
Right, are you gonna do the show at the tailgate?
Yes, we are. We're gonna be doing a live. Sorry for some of you who are tuning in a little late. We did announce that we will be doing a live remote podcast from our tailgate party at Citi Field this
absolutely.
Year.
Absolutely.
And I believe it's April 1st, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah.
Oh, no. April 1st is opening day. I believe the home opener is like the 12th or something.
Something like that.
We'll get you the dates, though, and we'll get it all out. And we'll have all the specifics. Usually it's $40 a year, all included. Drinks, everything, entertainment, food. You name it. It's just the greatest party of the year. Easily the greatest party of the year. Badass tailgate going hard and strong. And we hope you all will attend.
No Sam Champion there?
No Sam Champion.
Sam Champion's welcome, though.
Yeah, if he shows up, I think I would
he's
offer
a lot more
a
welcome than some other people.
Yeah.
But, yeah, Sam Champion, he's a good
I'd like to bring back Sam Champion and Mike Piazza for the
I would. You know what? Absolutely.
See what happens.
Mike Piazza shunned my son for an autograph.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, he's a douche for that.
When I was a kid.
There's no reason to be a douche to kids. I don't care. Make time, dude.
When I was a kid, my mother tells me the story. Where the players used to come out from the parking lot. Everybody ran up and they're getting these autographs. And they were like, go ahead, you know, go. And they're like, you sure? And I ran. And the player, whoever it was looking right at me. And when I got up to the car, rolled up the window and took off. And like the people were like they were mad. They were mad at him. They were throwing stuff at his car. My mother was telling the story. And I was like, from that moment on, I never asked for an autograph.
I was never into it either.
I was never into it. So I worked at the hospital for special surgery. and the Met physician was there. So I, you know, and also other players, the Giant physician. So I met Daryl Strawberry.
You should have kicked him in the nuts.
No, no. So Jay Payton was there. And I met Jay Payton.
The Mets were the only team that got injured, and then the doctor injured them
more. And
more.
they said, put a new ligament back. Yeah. He removed it.
Guys,
like, you know,
doing
he might
surgery
need
on
that.
The left leg, yeah. Got tore his right knee.
What? Like, how did he get spine surgery? Anyway, you know, when I came up with this idea and I proposed it to be done, I couldn't do it without you.
Right.
I wouldn't want to do it without you. Even
I
though, like,
it.
In my head, I was like, maybe I can do this solo thing. It just didn't seem right if I didn't do it without you.
I appreciate that.
So
I think the best compliment we got from the you gonna cry?
No.
We can't hug because it's COVID. Weird shit.
Yeah.
No, but I think that one of the best compliments that we got from last week from the preview show that we did, the 45, yeah. Which was really quick, 40 minutes. We didn't like plan anything. Again, like we didn't plan this, but
the I best, mean we planned other stuff.
Sort
it just
of,
didn't come out.
Right.
So.
But the best compliment that I think we got was that our energies feed off of each other. Like, you know, aside from the stuff that we'll clean up, you know, the bad, like, you know, the bad etiquette, radio etiquette, or whatever
etiquette.
You want to call it. But, I mean, grammar. Honestly, I think it's an entertaining show. I think we'll bring some funny laughs to people. I think as, you know,
if they
we
weren't
get better,
entertained by the two of us now
yeah,
and
no
what
doubt.
The shit they did, then
if,
they'll
as
never
we,
laugh.
As we get better, the show will get better. And the 100%. Topics, as, you know, it's,
everything will be more clear when we're presenting our points 100%. And what we're talking about, you know.
And I just, you know, so
this
that,
is just a rough, drunk episode.
Thank you for
episode.
That. I just wanted to thank you, though, because I wanted to show you the love for bringing this
hey,
all
cheers
together.
Cheers to you.
Cheers to you, buddy.
Cheers
thank
to you.
Thank you very much. And also,
James
thank
Moore.
You to you guys. Okay, I'm sorry, James Moore.
James Moore writes, April 7th, my birthday. Also, always been there.
Okay, happy birthday, James.
Yeah, happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
James.
All right, so, that was weird.
Happy.
James, happy birthday, I guess. I don't know. Come to the tailgate. Maybe we'll,
come
have,
to the
a,
tailgate. How
we'll
are,
have a cake for you or something. Yeah. I don't fucking know.
We'll have you sit down on the podcast.
Now, if people are going to start calling and telling us their birthdays
yeah.
or texting. And
hey, just give me a shout out for my birthday. I'll wait.
We are going to be a comedy show, so yeah. we will be making fun of some stupid shit.
Like your birthday.
Like your birthday.
Oh, yeah.
No, but anyway, listen, I want to thank all of you guys. All of the people like
everybody
James.
Everybody paying attention,
all of the people
watching,
that have messaged us and calls in. Our beautiful, beautiful, beautiful second halves.
The second. I'm two. She's one.
Tara's, you know, Mike's chauffeur and my beautiful Patricia Martucci.
Patricia.
Just, guys, I want you to understand how special this girl is to me. I love her so much. She helped me change careers. I am in a different path in my life because of her support. And I want to support her now by mentioning her amazing children's book that she wrote over the quarantine. We did a really good job of pushing each other to stay busy. Part of the quarantine, the birth of the quarantine, was the Pizza Gurus items. And the podcast was kind of like on the deep end in my real estate career. But Trish wrote a book, a children's book. She's a first grade teacher in Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn. And she wrote a book basically about her, you know, her life and experiences as a teacher.
It's a really good book, too.
It's a phenomenal book. It's called Princess Sophia. You could find it on Amazon. It's $9.99. Guys, it's an amazing, amazing read. If you have children,
it's
not a short book, three pages.
So
it's well worth it. You're getting a really good read. And again, she's a number one best-selling author on Amazon
that's
right now.
Most important, like that's
it's amazing.
It's
she's
awesome.
A number one. Yeah, I mean, in like five or six different categories, she's number one still. And she's the book has been out for a bunch of months.
Beautiful,
now.
Good for you.
So yeah, that, you know, much love to Trish and you know, full support. I love you, baby, with all my heart. And anybody, just you know, go out and buy the book. I also wanted to mention one more person, and this is just again, this is all small business support and people locally who need our help. And again, I'm just going to keep harping on it. I don't want to sound like, you know, a broken record, but this is important to us, you know, as far as being friendly with our people in our neighborhood. And Queens has always been one of those. We pride ourselves on supporting each other. That's kind of what we do, which is why we're friends with so many people for 30 freaking years. You
right.
know what I'm saying?
And the people that you made friends with, that how, there are these business owners, you yourself.
Right.
Top there, and then everyone else is say like the people that you become friends with and own it, like, and everybody that's our friends, they always talk about, when are you going to see Sean? They would always ask me, when are you going to see Sean? So when it was from bartending to owning, it was like they want me every time that I go to see you to tell
to
them
say,
so
well,
they can come.
They want to come in. But now we have an open forum to tell people,
right.
So I love it.
And
you know?
So, you know, like, you know.
So support small business. Small
show up every
bars.
Bar. We'll sign autographs, take pictures.
I'm not
that's
telling you to be an
amazing thing in the world. No?
Yeah, I'm not telling you to be an alcoholic, but I'm telling you to support as many bars as you can.
Yeah. Listen,
you know, like,
starts with Rebar,
work your way out.
And work your way out. I mean, we'll just scatter you all over the
but
place.
But I just want to mention one more person. And That is Michelle Gonzalez. She is a local photographer.
Okay.
Michelle is doing, she's awesome. Okay. Her work is, it speaks for itself. You could find her work on at Mitch G Photography. She's on Instagram. She's a female entrepreneur, and she's a mother, and she's a single mother of a young child. And, you know, so give props to anybody who starts their own company, who's a single mom doing it on her own.
Doing it on her own.
You can find her again on Facebook and Instagram at Michelle G Photography. She's a professional photographer servicing Queens and beyond. She specializes in newborn, family, and general portrait photography. She is currently running a contest on her Facebook page. So if you guys are interested, go to her Facebook page and you could enter to win a free portrait session. It's valued at $225.
Wow.
So she's giving you guys a free portrait session. So the family,
that's impressive. That's
for
great.
Any
that's...
of you family, you know, people who have kids and want to take pictures for school or whatever the case may be, call Michelle. Get on her Facebook, join this contest and, you know, and again, help support small business.
Yeah, big time.
She's going to be picking a winner at this coming weekend. So you have to get on like tomorrow, you know. So get on her website, get on her Facebook page now at Mitch G Photography and get into that contest. Again, thank you guys all so much. Thank you to Studio Mike. You are the man,
Mike,
even though you don't
you
know my
much.
Name. He literally calls me Sheen.
Sheen.
He calls me Sheen like 14 times a show. But you know what? I love you anyway. Thank you so much for all you're doing for us.
No,
and this,
this outlet that brings us in here to do this show. And he did mention that in his catalog of performers that he was looking for some
white bound.
Some white bound.
He said he wanted to bring some white balance to the force.
And so we bring white.
Balance of the white we need.
I hope I hope all the viewers like, add, and share. Also subscribe.
Like, add, and share. Yes.
It, you know, that's like the ultimate support. Like, that's like supporting a small business is supporting, the show. It's helping
and
us grow.
Is that's it. Also,
just tell people about
business.
It. If you liked it just even a little bit today, just tell people about it. Even if you didn't,
word.
If you didn't like it, tell people about it. Let them make a decision.
Most important, if you didn't like it, tell people
about
it.
Shout to Marcy. Thank you very much for putting us in touch with Mike. And
check
out Marcy's podcast on Mix Vibes Radio as well.
Beautiful.
Check out Mix Vibes Radio. There's a ton of podcasts on there that you can entertain yourselves with while you're in the car.
A long roster of some entertainment.
And thank you very much, everybody.
You.
We want to say have a good night and keep in touch with yourself.
Yeah. Love you.